Hello everybody and welcome back to my channel. Okay, so this is part two of the Dalia Dippolito case, and it's crazy. In the last video, we left off with Dalia doing everything in her power to remove her husband of 6 months, Mike Dippolito, from her life by any means necessary. When her efforts to have him thrown back in prison failed, she began searching for someone to help her kill him. Her motive for this was twofold. Firstly, she wanted Mike's townhouse, which he transferred to her name upon her request, along with whatever money he had left. And secondly, she just didn't want to be married to him. We talked about how Dalia had taken extreme measures, seeking out known violent criminals to enlist their help and reaching out to a local ex-boyfriend of hers, a man named Mohammed, to see if he could be of assistance in achieving her final goal of removing Mike Dippolito from her life and the world. So if you haven't seen part one yet, I suggest that you check that out first, or not much of this will make sense. The link to that will be posted in the description box. Before we launch in, let's have a word from our sponsor, and while you're listening to that, maybe go get yourself a drink, a cup of coffee, a snack. It's gonna be a long and crazy ride. So I think it's funny because a couple days ago, maybe just 4 days ago, I posted on Twitter, like, it seems like there's nothing good on YouTube anymore. Because I like watching things, long things especially, when I'm going about my business, folding laundry, whatever, going about my day, just trying to tune out the world. I like to listen to things on YouTube, and I felt like there wasn't a lot on YouTube, and a lot of you who, you know, commented on that Twitter post agreed. And then I remembered after I posted that, crap, I have Magellan TV. Like, there's so much on there. Let me pop up the app and see if there's anything new. And I actually found a new series that I've become obsessed with. It's so interesting. It's so perfect for this case, actually, that it's kind of crazy. The show is called Deadly Dates, and it says 90 million of us worldwide search for love online, but internet dating can be a dangerous game. Most of us never think about the dark side of the web and the predators who lurk there, so how well do you really know the person you're dating? There are several episodes in this series. I've already binged through three in the past couple of days. So for those of you who don't know, Magellan TV is a new kind of documentary streaming service. They have tons and tons of series and documentary movies, over 2,000, and they add more every single week. And honestly, it's the best part of my week when I get to look on Magellan and see the like new this week kind of category. I always love scrolling through that because there's so many cool things. Magellan TV was created and curated by the people who know what makes a good documentary best, the filmmakers. You can stream it on your Apple or Android phone, tablet, you can cast it to your Roku, you can cast it to Apple TV, whatever is easiest for you, whatever works for your life at that time. And if you start something on your phone, you can pick it back up wherever you left off on any device. There's tons of documentaries in 4K with no extra charge. Magellan TV has been a very, very good sponsor to this channel over the past 6 months or so. So I have come to really love and appreciate it, and I find myself going to that app before all others when I'm looking for a documentary. If you want to try Magellan free for 30 days, go to the link in the description box. Magellan TV is going to give you 30 days free. You have that whole month to explore, to check things out, to see if you like it. If you don't, you can cancel at the end of that month, but I don't think you're going to want to. So thank you so much to Magellan TV for sponsoring this channel. Sponsors like Magellan TV keep this channel going and allow me to continue bringing you content. You know that sometimes our videos get demonetized because we talk about things that, are tough to hear. So sponsors keep this channel going. You guys watching the sponsors and being interested in the sponsors, checking them out if you're interested, that helps this channel as well. So thank you so much to everybody out there, and let's get started on the video. Okay, so Mohammed is now officially a police informant, but first they have to figure out who this woman is. Remember, Dalia and Mohammed have known each other for a long time, like a decade, but he doesn't know her real name. He knows her as Delilah, and he has no idea what her last name is or what the name of her husband, the intended victim, is. He has a rough idea of where she lives. He was aware that the mobile station they met at was close to her house. So the same night that he signs the CI agreement, they put him in a police cruiser and they drive him around the surrounding neighborhoods to see if he recognizes something, such as Dalia or Mike's car parked in a driveway. They were unable to locate the Dippolito home, so that same night they told Mohammed to call Dalia and tell her that he's agreed to help her. But it was late, it was a little after midnight, so when Mohammed called Dalia, she didn't answer, most likely because she was with her husband at home. She did answer the next day when he called, however, and during this phone call, he informed her that he'd found a guy, a professional, who could help her with her problem, and they needed to meet again to go over the details, but this time she should bring $3,000 and pictures of her husband to give to the hitman. They made plans to meet at the same mobile station by her house. On Saturday, August 1st, Mohammed met with a detective, Alex Moreno, of the Boynton Beach Police Department. The meeting with Dalia was going down the next day, and they had to get him wired up so that they could get it all on tape. As they were attempting to place the wire in the normal area that they would put it, which would be like in his pants, Mohammed stopped them, and he told them that they'd probably need to put it somewhere else because it was pretty common whenever he and Dalia were together that she would go straight for his crotch, and he didn't want her to discover the wire. They did put the wire someplace else on his person, but without his knowledge, they also placed a camera in the pocket of a shirt that was hanging in the back seat. This may seem a little sketchy, but he did sign a paper that gave them permission to do so, so legally, they weren't doing anything wrong or illegal or immoral. The BBPD also set surveillance up at the gas station prior to Mohammed and Dalia arriving, and they placed two undercover detectives at gas pumps pretending to be regular customers filling up. Detective Paul Sheridan was tasked with following Mohammed to the mobile station and parking strategically so that he'd always have eyes on Mohammed's car. Half a dozen other undercover officers were placed around the station masquerading as regular customers. Now, I can't really find a good recording or video of this conversation. I may have found one, but I don't know how the quality is and how the sound is, so if I find that and I can get it cleaned up, I'll enter it here, I'll put it in the video, but if not, I'll just give you a quick breakdown of what took place. As Dalia was getting into Mohammed's car, the Boynton Beach Police Department was running the plates on the vehicle she got out of so they could get her identification and address, and of course, the car was registered to Mike Dippolito, so they assumed that he was the victim. When she gets in his car, Mohammed asks her if she's concerned about someone getting killed over money, and not really a huge amount of money at that, all things considered.
The thing is, it's like me going and filing for divorce, like he'll come after my ass, period.
This guy, this is all he does. I'm giving him the deposit.
She responded, it wasn't even about the money. A divorce would ruin her. She said that when Mike had divorced his ex-wife Maria, it hadn't really mattered because Maria had nothing to her name. But if Dalia tried to divorce Mike, he'd come after her for everything she had. She also told Mohammed that she was concerned Mike was into some pretty deep, dark stuff, and she didn't want to get caught in the crossfire. She mentioned that she and Mike had been at Target that same day, and they'd run into an old friend of his, who she believed was involved with organized crime. After her whole spiel, Mohammed tells Dalia that he thinks he found a guy who would do it, but it's a serious guy, a professional, one who does this stuff for a living, and once she starts going down that path, there's no turning back. Once again, he's giving her an out. He's trying to see if there's potential for her to change her mind. Later, in one of her many trials, Dahlia's defense team would accuse everyone and their mother of trying to set Dalia up, including the BBPD. But we can clearly see here that Dalia is given multiple opportunities to understand the gravity of what she's about to do, and she still goes full steam ahead. Dalia and Mohammed together inspect the pictures that Dalia brought along with her, pictures of her husband that she dug up specifically for their use in giving to a hitman so he'd be able to identify his target. She decides on a picture of Mike and her grandfather, but tells Mohammed she doesn't want her grandfather in the picture, and when he tells her that they'll have to cut him out, she chooses one of just Mike instead, which seems like that would have been the better picture to go with initially anyways. They also chat a little bit about Danny Coe and the Buckwild gang, with Mohammed once again reinforcing her that he had told her to stay away and that she should have listened. He does also call her out on what Danny Coe told him, that she'd offered up his Range Rover, Mohammed's car that she'd bought him for payment. Now, I don't know if this was part of the script or if Mohammed was just still really salty over this. And in true Dalia fashion, you know, she doesn't tell anybody anything that's the truth. She tells people what they want to hear while still doing whatever she wants in the process. She never owns up to anything, so she assures Mohammed that she didn't mean that. You know, she just said it. She just said it to get him to help her. When Mohammed asks about Mike's family, wondering if they'll be suspicious about his death, she responds, "Why me? No one is going to point a finger at me." She's so sure she has everyone fooled. She can't even fathom the idea that anyone might think she was capable of setting up her husband's murder. What she doesn't seem to know or really care about is that most of the people in Mike's life, including his mother, had been suspicious of Dalia since the start. Dalia tells Mohammed that she wants it done by the following Wednesday, which he says is fine because this hitman is a former military guy and he was flying out of the country to Costa Rica on Thursday for another job. In this plan, Mohammed will be the go-between, and he'd need $1,200 upfront in order to give the hitman so that the hitman can buy a gun. But Dalia will also need to meet with this guy face-to-face, and Mohammed wants to be paid $20,000 for arranging the whole thing, since he's taking a pretty big risk as well. Mohammed also asks for $200 that day just to, like, tide him over. But Dalia tells him that her account is overdrawn, but she's good for it. You know, she'll get him his money and the assassin's money. According to transcripts in this video, you can clearly see Dalia hand Mohammed the money, $1,200 in cash. And she also reminds him to wipe her prints off the pictures. Before she gets out of the car, she says, "And we will never talk about it again, okay?" They agree to be out of contact for the next day or two. She gets out of the car. On Monday, August 3rd, Mohammed called Dalia to tell her that the hitman would be in touch with her very shortly. And during this call, he'll tell her where and when they'll be meeting. Mohammed also offers to go to the meeting with her for moral support. She says she'd like that, and Mohammed tells her to follow directions, keep quiet, and get out of there as soon as possible. Now remember, Mohammed's working with the Boynton Beach Police Department, so this call would be recorded. Everything he's saying to her, he's been instructed to say by the police department. They need to control the situation to make sure that there are very few opportunities for Mohammed and Dalia to talk alone. Unrecorded. And it's as if Dalia knows this or suspects this because 90 minutes later, she texts Mohammed as she's driving and tells him that she's on her way to his house to talk. Mohammed, he's panicked, right? He calls Detective Moreno, he explains Dahlia's plan, and they obviously don't want Dalia showing up at Mohammed's house, which isn't wired for surveillance. So Moreno tells him, just come up with something, you know, make something up, make sure that Dalia does not show up at your house. Mohammed calls Dalia, and they do have a recording of this. During the car, Dalia does something strange, right? So she pulls her car over to the side of the road, she gets out and she walks away from her car while she's on the phone with Mohammed. And she does this allegedly because she's concerned there might be a wire in her car. So she doesn't want to have this kind of conversation in the car where she might be being recorded. And that's why she gets out. It could also be because she was driving Mike's car at that point, and she'd called in so many false tips on him. She was concerned the car could be bugged or tracked by the police. But she is being recorded by Mohammed and the Boynton Beach Police Department, unbeknownst to her. During this call, Dalia paces back and forth while she tells Mohammed that Mike will be at the Bank of America in Boca Raton on Wednesday morning as soon as they open, and he's going to be withdrawing $10,000. She wanted to know if Mohammed thought that the hitman would just do the job there and then at the bank and take the money that Mike withdrew as payment. It's completely unbelievable. This woman has stolen almost $200,000 from her husband. She spent it all. And now she's broke and her account is overdrawn, so she'd like her husband to do the work of getting out the money to pay for his own death. Somehow, though, Mohammed convinces her it's not a good time to stop by, so she turns around and goes back home where she receives a call from the hitman at about 2:30 p.m. He told her he was driving from Miami and wanted to meet with her in 2 hours. He also instructed her to bring a key to her house and $3,000 for a down payment. Now, of course, this wasn't a real hitman. This was an undercover police officer, a man named Witty Jean. He was a black police officer who the BBPD had claimed they chose for this role because he fit the part better than the other officers. They said he fit the part because his hair was long enough to put into braids, while the others had short, close-cropped military hairstyles. Witty Jean was also trained in undercover operations. He'd worked in narcotics, so he knew what he was doing in a situation like this. Something important to note here is Dalia was already guilty of a crime when she handed Mohammed the money in his car, which they have on tape. But the Boynton Beach Police Department, they kind of wanted to see how much more they could get. knowing that if they went to trial with this case, they would need a really open and shut case with no gray areas. Not long after she got off the phone with Witty Jean, Dalia called Mohammed and she asked him if he thinks the hitman would take less up front, as she was a bit short on cash. She also whined to him about why the guy had asked for a key to her house, expressing concern that he would rob her while he was there killing her husband. She said, quote, "I thought you said this wouldn't get personal. I don't like talking about this over the phone." Before Dalia met with the fake hitman, she and Mohammed, they got together at Chili's, which was right across the street from the designated meetup spot that Witty Jean had given her. Now, this Chili's meeting would come under fire later during the trials. It was a short time, only about 30 minutes, but the surveillance equipment had allegedly malfunctioned. And since they were more concerned with getting the meetup with Witty Jean on tape, they didn't want to take away resources from that scene in order to get the Chili's meeting on tape. So the plan was to meet Witty Jean across the street from the Chili's in a CVS parking lot. Mohammed is with Dalia, and she tells Witty Jean that he's her cousin, and he's just there to make sure she's safe. When they arrive at CVS, Dalia struts over to Witty Jean's red Sebring convertible. She's dressed to kill, literally, right? She's wearing a tight, short blue dress with her hair in this cute little ponytail cascading down her back in shining waves. She slides into his car, and the first thing that he tells her is that she looks beautiful. So immediately, someone like Dalia is going to think, okay, this is familiar territory for me. Here's a man who's attracted to me, and I have the power. I have the upper hand, a position that Dalia had enjoyed comfortably for most of her life. After that comment, you can immediately see that she looks more at ease. I'm going to play you clips of this conversation, which was obviously recorded. The police had drilled a hole in the backseat of the car and placed a hidden camera in there. In the interest of time, I obviously can't play the whole video, but I've linked it down below if you want to watch it in its entirety.
Hey.
We're staying in here, right?
How about you? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Man, you look good.
Thank
you. Set me up a little bit. You all right?
Yeah, I'm okay. Yeah.
Okay. No, I'm good. I'm good. Just that, you know.
They do a little talking. He's warming her up a bit. He tells her how much he needs, at that point, $3,000, and then he can do his thing. He asks her for some information on Mike and to see how she would like it done. When he asks if Mike is her boyfriend or her husband, like how long you guys been together, who is he to you, she laughs a little. And he's like, no, for real. After I talk to you today, it's on. You won't be able to get a hold of me, and I want to make sure that this is what you want.
Is he your husband or something? Boyfriend? Your husband? How long y'all been married? No, for real, because the thing is, you know, after I talked to you today, you know, this phone, garbage.
Okay.
You won't be able to get a hold of it. Okay, I just want to make sure that, you know, it's what you want.
No.
All right?
Once again, the Boynton Beach Police Department is giving Dalia a chance to back out, to change her mind, to at least make it look not as bad for her. Most likely, they would have arrested her anyways for a solicitation of murder, but at least if it went to trial, she would have looked more sympathetic, and she may have been able to plead down to a lesser charge. Once again, here he asks her, are you sure you want to kill this dude? And she laughs.
Sure you want to kill this dude?
Could we really have to? You know, it's just, I'd rather be at less, you know, what
okay.
I'm going to feel.
Alright,
Whether it be a nervous laugh or if she was truly amused, I'm not sure. But I'm also not sure it was the best reaction to have to that question. She doesn't want to come right out and say the words. She's still suspicious and nervous, and rightly so, since she's committing a crime at that very moment. And to Witty Jean's credit, he does play the part very well, and he is convincing. So you can see as this video progresses, Dalia gets more comfortable, talks more openly about what her intentions are.
Because a lot of times, you know, whatever I get from whatever money I get from you, most of it goes into, you know, planning and getting people to do stuff.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
That's just the way it is.
How soon can we get everything going?
Well, it's up to you.
I mean, it's not like this week, but like my understanding of everything was is that, like, you know, I was going to give you what I gave you, and then that was everything.
Oh, I gave I.
Until after the fact, and then after the fact, I guess you were gonna come and like find me or whatever, or you were gonna tell me like, where it was supposed to go. That's why, like today, when you asked for money, you threw me off guard, and I told you okay.
I said to you, okay,
because you know I'm not gonna get on the phone and do whatever, like over, you know. But
Okay.
I mean, I'm good for it. Like, it's not like I don't have it anything. Or, you know what I mean? Like, I understand your position. Like, I went ahead and I gave 12 with the understanding that after everything was already handled, you were going to come and find me. And I mean, I know not to fuck around with you. You know certain things, whatever. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you obviously know where I'm at.
She is sitting in a car, planning her husband's murder, and she's trying to haggle with the man she thinks is an actual hitman. She's like, I thought I was just going to give you this money, and then after the fact, you'd find me for the rest. You know, I already gave you $1,200 for the gun. I didn't bring any money with me today. She doesn't want to give him all the money up front because, of course, she's nervous that he won't go through with it, and also because she doesn't have it. She spent all her money. Her account's overdrawn. She doesn't have money. She's got to find someone to manipulate to get more money. He tells her that he wants the $3,000 that day. This is typically how hitmen operate. They want half up front, half later. She claims that this request had thrown her off guard because of the $1,200 she'd already given him. She didn't know she'd have to come up with more money that quickly, which was a lie. Mohammed told her she'd need $3,000. So she never physically hands Witty Jean any money in this video, which her lawyers will mention ad nauseum later during her trial. Now, Witty Jean is trying to explain to her the life of a hitman. He's like, yeah, that $1,200 was like operating cost, you know, to buy the heat, the gun, to do my research, get a burner phone, rent a car, etc.
My thing is that I'll give you a quick breakdown of what I've done so far. You know, I got $1,200 from the dude, all right? $1,200 went to buy my heat, my gun, okay? And a couple hundred, you know, for other people to do things. You know what I mean? That's pretty much it. As a matter of fact, I've already spent more money, you know, just to get here.
Right.
You understand? Because I had to get this car, I got to get rid of this car, I had to get this phone, I got to get rid of this phone.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's a lot more I had to do.
I know. But like I told you, like, I can't keep coming out of, like, I've come out of pocket a lot for, like, a lot of other
things. No, that's fine.
But you know what I mean? Like, I can't get into it, like, or whatever.
That's all right.
But I still need to be paid, you know, for my time and my efforts. And she wants him to know. And she says the word. Don't worry, I'm good for it, you know? I'm good for it. I know you know where to find me. I know not to mess with you. I'll have your money.
You know, I'm in the position where, like, I told you, like, I'm good for it. Like, the day that you needed it, you know, it's like I came, I met that day, it was handled. You know what I mean? Like, that's the kind of person that I am.
Okay.
Today, you threw me off guard when you called me at, like, 2, and it's not like, you know what I mean? I have a stash under my pillow.
He tells her that he can get it done by Wednesday, and she confirms this will work for her as if she's setting a doctor's appointment, right? There's no emotion. There's no doubt. There's no second guessing. She literally just agrees. As soon as he says Wednesday morning, she's like, yeah, that's great. Sooner the better.
If you want it done tonight, tomorrow, or the week, I understand. I could get it done by Wednesday if you want me to.
Right.
You understand? But I got to do my homework, you know?
Right.
I got to, you know exactly where the place is and how to get out of there, how to get in and out. You understand what the neighbors want? I got to call the cops, you know, report a shooting to see how fast they get to that location. There's a lot of stuff I got to do.
Now, they talk about the plan for Wednesday, and Witty Jean claims he's read the papers. There have been a lot of robberies in Dalia and Mike's neighborhood, so it's not going to be hard to break in during the day, thinking that most people would be at work, stumble upon Mike, who is home, and give him 2 in the head, setting it up to make it look like a robbery gone wrong. She nods during this whole explanation. She gives affirmative statements such as, yeah, uh-huh, sure, etc.
How are we going to do it? So if we go ahead and we do it, like, at the house, like, how soon could you do it?
I could do it Wednesday morning. Wednesday morning at the house, because I was looking in the newspapers here. There's been a lot of burglaries in this area. All right? It's not uncommon for someone to break into a house. Okay? It's going to be like I break into the house, you know, didn't think he was going to be home because everybody works in the daytime.
Right.
I'm going to think he's at work. Boom, he's not at work. Then, you know, he gets 2 in the head. That's it, you know. I take a couple things with me, break a couple windows, make it look like a robbery that went bad. It's all over. I'm gone out of there. You understand? I'm not gonna be by myself. I'm gonna have other people watching my back, you know, doing the thing. You know what I'm saying? Because does he have guns in the house?
No.
All
right. He's right now. He's on probation, and so there's a lot of people that don't like him.
All right. What's his name?
Mike.
Mike. All right. Okay.
So eventually he tells her, no biggie, listen, you don't have to give me the money right now. If you want, you can even leave my payment someplace for me in the house. But if you want it done somewhere else, then yes, I'm going to have to meet with you later to collect. And that's when she comes up with a plan that she previously brought up to Mohammed. Mike is going to the bank to withdraw money for his business partner, who's located literally right next to the bank. And if the hitman wants to get Mike while he's at the bank, he can just steal that $10,000 from him and use it as his payment. It's worth noting Mike Dippolito did plan on going to the bank that morning, Wednesday, August 5th, and he was going to be taking cash out of his safety deposit box for one of his business partners, but he didn't have 10 grand in that box. Dalia had made sure of that, and she knew he wasn't withdrawing that much. He would never have withdrawn that much from a regular bank, as it would notify the IRS.
That's why I wanted to know, like, do you want to come to my house Wednesday, or do you just want to, you know what I mean? I don't know what kind of scenes you do, whatever. He's going to be going to the bank on Wednesday. I don't know if... You know,
okay.
Yeah, I don't know if that's too public for you, or
what's
he doing at the bank? He has to pull out money
for his business partner. Oh, he's not gonna, okay, so he doesn't have any money at the house, man?
He's like hard cash. He's pulling and pulling out the money because he has to make it look like it's coming from an account from his business partner.
Okay.
Like a business account.
How much money?
He said he was pulling out, I think, around 10.
That might even be better.
He's going into the bank on Wednesday and he's pulling out money, like I know what bank he's going to, in Boca. Are you familiar with Boca? I could find out. I know exactly where, what time, everything. Okay. So I don't know if, you know, the problem with this though is that from where the bank is to where the partner's office is literally like next door to each other.
Okay,
like he's gonna have to get back in the car to go there. I know where the office is at and everything like that. Like I could show you where everything's at.
His office, his apartment.
Yeah.
She's lying to this man, a hitman, a man who she thinks is a cold-blooded killer. I'm not sure what her plan was for when the hit went down and the killer would discover there wasn't 10 grand to be stolen. Maybe she thought he would just take whatever was there and run. Maybe she thought if he confronted her about it, she could just bat her eyes and flirt her way out of it. But I tell you what, this girl is living on the edge. I wouldn't lie to a hitman, would you? At one point, Wirijan mentions that he just wants to make sure Dalia is going to be okay under police questioning in the aftermath of this orchestrated tragedy. He says he doesn't know how well she handles pressure, to which she responds confidently, "I'm a lot tougher than I look. I know you're thinking, oh, what a cute little girl, whatever. I'm not," as she laughs about this.
I don't know how well you handle pressure. And
I'm not gonna, you know, I'm a lot tougher than what I look. I know you're thinking, you're like, oh, what a cute little girl, whatever. But I'm not, you're beautiful, thank you, but I just need to make sure everything's gonna take care of. All right, okay, so you pay me back and how much are you paying me?
So Dalia really wants him to do it at the bank, not at the house. And the reason for this is because she doesn't want this guy, this hitman, to take her stuff while making it look like a robbery gone wrong. She even tells him that there's not anything like valuable at our house. There's no money. There's nothing there. You know, you'd look at our house and you'd think we have a lot of nice stuff. We got valuable stuff here and lots of money, but we don't. Unless you want to just like drive away with Mike's Porsche. That's what she says. So now not only is she offering up Mike's money to the hitman, but offering up basically his precious car, like suggesting that, you know, if you want something really valuable, my husband's got a Porsche in the garage. I can give you the key to that, but I don't want to give you the key to my house. At some point during this interaction, Mohammed walks up to the car to make sure everything's okay. And Dalia says she's fine and he leaves. So Wirijan asks her if she's going to be home Wednesday morning and she confirms that she will be, so they develop an alibi. She says that she can go to the gym that morning and she'll go to the gym the next morning as well so that it doesn't look suspicious if she decides to go again on Wednesday. She keeps telling him that Mike always walks the dogs around 6:30 and 7 and he leaves the door to the townhouse unlocked while he's doing this. And there's a part where she almost catches him. And if she had been a little bit more astute, it would have been a red flag. He says, okay, I'll be at the house early. And she says, well, how do you know where I live? And he stumbles a little bit, telling her like, oh, I've seen a picture of your house. And she's like, yeah, but do you know which one is mine? And he's like, yeah, which one is yours? You know, it was pretty awkward, but she seems to have moved past that pretty quickly. Once again, Wirijan wants to make sure that Dalia is sure. He tells her, you won't be able to reach me after today. This is a burner phone and it won't be on anymore. He says, I want to make sure you're not going to change your mind. She responds with the words that will forever haunt her. There's no changing my mind. I'm determined. I am 5,000% sure.
done, you know, you have to have an option to change your mind. Even if you change your mind, you're not talking
only. There's no changing, no, there's no, like, determined already. I'm positive, like, 5,000% sure, like,
okay.
I was stressing when you told me you were going to come up here, and then I'm, like, looking at the time, I'm like, what the fuck, he's not coming, he's not good,
no,
you know, it's like,
that's it.
All this stuff or whatever. Like, no, when I say I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it. Like, as soon as he told me I was going to need the money from you, I went, I grabbed it right away, like, we were good to go. Like, with me, you're not going to have a problem, you're not going to have an issue, you know what I mean? Nothing of nothing, I just...
As she's getting out of the car, she tells him thank you because you got to keep your manners intact no matter what situation you're in. So Dalia and Edwidi Jean, the fake hitman, they leave it with two different plans. Either he'll do it at the bank and take Mike's money, or he'll do it early in the morning before Mike goes to the bank, sneaking into the house while he's walking the dogs. The next day, Edwidi Jean calls Dalia and tells her the bank thing isn't going to work, and to make sure she's on her way to the gym by 6. Now, the Boynton Beach Police Department had decided that the Boca Raton location wouldn't work because it was out of their jurisdiction, and they didn't want to bring in and brief a whole nother police department. Better to keep everything in Boynton Beach, that way you don't have any issues with jurisdiction. Okay, now we're right up to the day of the planned murder. But before we go on, I want to talk to you about another important character that we've already touched on briefly, but we haven't gone into great detail about his relationship with Dalia. Now, this is Mr. Mike Stanley, Dalia's ex-lover, and the man who showed up on her birthday while she was at dinner with Mike and her family, allegedly to win her back. His part in all of this, it's not complete yet. It's not done. According to Mike Dippolito, from what he knew, Mike Stanley was Dalia's ex-boyfriend who she'd lived with for 3 years before moving back to Florida and marrying him. But according to Dalia's cell phone records, Stanley's number was called by her several times in the weeks leading up to Mike Dippolito's planned murder. Hundreds of texts between Dalia and Stanley were also recovered during that time. Now, according to Mike Stanley, he hadn't even spoken to Dalia after trying to win her back that day on her birthday. He'd just gone back to California and said, okay, this is a loss. I gotta move on with my life. But she had unexpectedly called him in July to tell him that her dog, Bella, a dog they'd bought together, needed some teeth removed, and he kindly offered to pay for it. After that, their communication resumed, and then some. Here is a text exchange between them right around this time. Dalia says, quote, "Hey, it's me. Call me back." Stanley says, "I'm sure your little toes look great. Hey, you. I almost fell off my chair that you left me a voicemail." Dalia says, "Really? LOL. I miss you." Stanley says, "Happy to hear that. I'm smiling. Soulmates." And this is followed by multiple smiley face emojis. Dalia says, "Mwah." And Stanley says, "What is mwah?" And Dalia says, "A kiss, goofy." And Stanley says, "Ha, I'll take it." Dalia then responds, "I want you." And Stanley says, "Wow, I want you." And Dalia says, "Just know, no one has ever made me feel the way that you have. You always spoiled and romanced me. I loved it." Stanley says to her, "I was truly in love with you, so crazy about you, and have never felt that way before or after you." And Dalia responds, "Thank God for that." The next night, the texting resumed. Now, these get a little dirty, okay? Just a fair warning. I'm going to be blushing and cringing the whole time. Mike Stanley says, "Sorry, wish we were together. I am thinking of you." Dalia responds, "Me too. I want you and Hank. LOL." So later, Mike Stanley would claim that Hank was a nickname for his heart, but I tend to think it was a nickname for another part of his anatomy. And then Dalia follows that up with, "I want to feel you in me." And Stanley says, "Ouch." Dalia responds, "What? LOL, are you speechless? Do you want my hot, tight body all over you?" Stanley responds, "Yes, but the reality is having you. Have a nice night, babe." Wow. So Dalia is getting shut down, right? She's getting rejected. Did Mike Stanley, in his advanced age, with enough time and space between the passion that he and Dalia had shared, gain some perspective? Did he come to understand that even though he enjoyed being physical with Dalia, that this would always lead to something else, something that would bring her and all her drama back into his life, and he wasn't ready to dive back in? Go off, Kang. Yes. Get out of there. No, no. Unfortunately, no. Dalia seems to have perfected the art of love sex magic, because the next morning, Stanley texted her saying, "The answer to your question would be hell yeah." They text back and forth flirtatiously over the next 5 days pretty consistently, and on July 15th, they met at the Marriott less than a mile away from the West Palm Beach Airport around noon. Now, she remains at this hotel with him for 5 hours. And during this time, she's also active on her phone, setting up dates for her girls in California. Later that evening, she texts him, "I love you, baby." And Stanley responds, "Infinity plus, LOL. I love you, sweetheart." Dalia says, "Soulmates, I'm so happy I saw you, baby." Stanley says, "Me too, soulmates." And Dalia says, "I really wish you would have done something in me." I'm not going to say the word, but it starts with a C. Stanley responds, "Ugh, me too. I'm sorry." Dalia responds, "LOL, baby. I love you, and I only want to F you. I'll be waiting for you. You've made me smile and laugh. I haven't done that in forever." Okay, so let's place ourselves quickly into the timelines of Mike and Dahlia's life while she's sexting with her ex-boyfriend, meeting him at hotels, and telling him that she wished that he would have done something in her and that she only wants to F him. This is after all the drama went down with the wire transfer, after Mike's money has pretty much vanished, she's spent it all, she's gone through it, after she's told him that she's pregnant, which she isn't, after she's already reconnected with Mohammed and tried to enlist a violent gang to kill Mike, after she's already told Mohammed that she wants Mike dead, but before she attempted to poison Mike's Starbucks chai tea latte with antifreeze. Right before, but still before. And this is also right before Dalia tells Mike that she knows a lawyer in Miami who can get him on administrative probation. Now, I almost wonder if she was trying to get pregnant for real so that she'd have a cover. Even if the dates didn't add up, like if, you know, Mike had thought she was 4 months pregnant and then she doesn't have the baby for like 15 months. She knew in her heart she could probably convince Mike that things like meth and gestational periods weren't important, and she was the exception to those rules. On July 17th, Dalia and Stanley continue texting, and it's getting more and more inappropriate. Dalia asks him, "So, how much do you want me?" And Stanley responds, "I've always wanted you. You're my unicorn." Dalia responds to him, "What you said was beautiful. I started crying. You're the man of my dreams, Prince Charming." And on July 24th, Dalia texts Mike Stanley and says, "I'm so attracted to you. Loved effing you. It blew me away. Loved having your hot C in me." On July 25th, Dalia texts him again, "What time will you be here? I want to start baby making." That same day, Dalia was supposed to meet Mike Stanley at the Blue Martini, the place that they had met for the first time, just hopeless romantics, the two of them, where she stood him up. He claimed he waited there for a while before going to see The Hangover alone. She texted him later, "Soulmates is what we are. We are meant to be together. Do you know I have baby names picked out? I want your child in me." So, I mean, yeah, I definitely think that she was trying to get pregnant so that she could tell Mike Dippolito, her husband, like, "Look, see, I really am pregnant. I mean, I'm way less pregnant than we thought before, but, you know, doctors get things like this wrong all the time." Mike Stanley and Dalia met up the next day, which was July 26th, and the day after, on July 27th, Dalia texts Mike Stanley and says, "The sooner his shit gets effed up, the better. The sooner he gets jammed up, the sooner we can be in Paradise Island, baby. I love you. I just want my life with you. Let's get this mother effer arrested. I'm so tired of his shit." She also sends a text that says, "He has some here at the house too, but I want to put X pills and coke in his car and Xanax." She texts again later, "Let's get this shit handled and we'll have it all. I really hate him and I want to see him rot. Let's get his lying ass back in jail." So what is Dalia doing here with Mike Stanley? Did she really miss him? Was she pining for him? Did she think that he was her soulmate? Well, you let me know what you think in the comments, but personally, I believe that none of the above was true. She tried to enlist the help of all these other people with no luck. Her plans weren't working out on her own, and as she typically did, she tracked down a man who she knew had feelings for her in order to use him for her own agenda. But what does Mike Stanley have to say about all of this? What were his explanations? He was obviously interviewed later when his number kept popping up in her phone records. Well, it gets a little convoluted, and his story seems to change a few times, but here's what he said. Mike Stanley denied that they'd been intimate when they met at the Marriott in July. He claimed they'd gotten together at the hotel coffee shop and that he'd seen a bruise on Dahlia's arm, which he stated looked like a handprint. When he asked her about it, she told him her husband had done it, that he was a terrible, abusive person physically and verbally. Her husband forced her to do things she didn't want to do, and he was a dangerous criminal who she feared was returning to his old ways. There were some scary guys looking for him since he had skimmed $100,000 from these men, and he had to pay up now. She also said that the police had already been on to Mike. She had the police reports to prove it, and that he threatened her and her family. So like a normal person, you know, Mike Stanley suggests that Dalia should go to the police, but she said no. You know, he's dangerous. He's crazy. I'm afraid for my life. And it would be Mike Stanley who over the next couple of weeks would help Dahlia's cause by calling in tips to the IRS and the FBI and Mike's probation officer trying to get him arrested. He called the Treasury Department on Dahlia's instructions to tell them that Mike owed all this money for court-ordered restitution, but he seemed to have enough money to buy two houses with cash. After investigating Mike Stanley's phone records, the police were able to determine that he'd also been the one who called Mike, pretending to be a lawyer helping him with administrative probation. He used this service that allows you to make spoof calls, giving you the ability to make your number look like any number you want, and it even gives the option to change your voice. Mike Stanley would tell the lawyers that Dalia was the one who'd shown him this service and shown him how to make a spoof call. So technically, what he was doing was illegal, posing as a lawyer, posing as someone that he wasn't, with the intention to defraud somebody, to have Mike sign over his house to Dalia. And when Mike Stanley was asked why he had helped Dalia with this plan, he claimed, get this, Mike was in on it. He was a sexual deviant and a tyrant, and according to Dalia, her husband thought it was hot to screw around with her ex-boyfriends. Stanley claimed that he'd been told by Dalia, and he believed that some of the texts to him from Dahlia's phone came from Mike Dippolito, and some of them were from Dalia, but dictated by Mike. So, like, he was standing right there next to her, telling her what to say. So Mike Stanley says that if he received texts that were racy or sexual in nature, he knew they were from Mike. And if he called the number back to find out, Mike would pick up, like, screaming and swearing at him. He said that this was Mike Dippolito's game, that he got some sick enjoyment out of it. According to Stanley, when he was responding to these messages, he did so in a way that he would if Dalia was sending them herself, even though he knew that some of them were not directly from Dalia, which makes complete sense to me. Stanley also said that since Mike Dippolito was playing a game with them and he knew about everything, he himself was innocent of any crime. But text messages from July 22nd show us that Mike Stanley was privy to a lot more of Dahlia's activities than he claimed to be. This was the same day Dalia met with Mohammed and tried to steal his gun from his car. So Dalia sends several messages to Mike Stanley, and she starts off by saying, "Did the transfer, but he says because we're married, I can't sell it without his signature, even though it's in my name. I want my life with you right now. We'd be getting our party weekend started. I love you. You're my world. Help me figure this out, love of my life. We have a lot of catching up to do." She also goes on to say, "I am so unhappy and empty without you. I can't stand being here. You should be here, not him. I can't stop crying. I love you. I'm such a mess right now." Now, Mike Stanley is obviously beside himself at this point. He wants to help her. He wants to take her pain away. He's compelled to do anything he can to just make things better for her, which is exactly how she wants him to feel. But he responds to her in a pretty normal way, and he says, "You need to clean up your mess, baby. Life is waiting. Next day, July 23rd, Dalia and Mike Stanley have a lengthy phone call, after which she texts him and says, "Baby, I am blown away. Stars are lining up for us." Later this evening, she would meet with Mohammed at the mobile gas station to arrange a hitman to kill her husband, right? She'd speak to Stanley on the phone before and after this meeting, calls which we have no record of. We don't know what took place or what was said, but later, she would text him kind of strangely, almost like she was pretending to be a gangster. And he played along, which makes me suspect that he knew what she'd been doing that day, allegedly, just my opinion. So she texts him and she says, "What up, dog? LOL. Does that sound impersonal?" And Stanley responds, keeping up the game, "Yo, yo, chillin', tired, headed to Connecticut, LOL." And Dalia responds, "Tell your peeps hola, LOL." And then Stanley responds, and he says this, "Hey, thanks for the service. My confidence is so much better, and I think I may start seeing someone very serious. I talk to girls so much better now," followed by a smiley face emoji. And Dalia responds, "No problem. I'm glad the role playing has helped you. Good luck and stay in touch." And Stanley responds, "Thank you. I feel more comfortable expressing myself now." So what's Mike Stanley's explanation for this bizarre exchange? Are you ready for this? It's good. He claims that they were role-playing the whole time, and he'd essentially hired or enlisted Dalia for help in building his confidence and showing him how he should flirt with women. That was the end game the whole time. She was just teaching him how to talk to girls. That's what he said. That's what he really said. It's beyond ridiculous. And on top of that, he said that Mike knew about this little role-playing game the whole time. One benefit to Mike Stanley's truly unbelievable and ludicrous story was that he'd given these statements while being deposed, which meant he was under oath. And he was clearly lying, right? Dahlia's lawyers would be less enthusiastic to use him as a witness during the trial and put him on the stand if he was going to tell the judge and jury a dumb story like that. Literally nobody would believe. I suspect, just my opinion, okay? Nobody come for me. I suspect that Dalia let Mike Stanley know what she was doing, that she was in the process of hiring someone to take out her husband, and once that was done, they could be together. But in the meantime, they should probably communicate with each other in an impersonal way and come up with some sort of story of why they'd been sexting the last several weeks, talking about being the love of each other's lives and soulmates and unicorns and all that jazz. The fact that Mike would soon be dead, murdered, allegedly, would spark an investigation. They would most likely look into Dahlia's communications and they'd find these exchanges. Now, a woman who's actively carrying on an affair while married, whose husband suddenly and mysteriously turns up dead, is going to raise more suspicion than a woman who's just trying to help an old friend improve his game with the ladies. So now we're back to August 5th, right? The day of the fake murder. The BBPD had cops staked out watching the house, and as soon as Dalia left for the gym, they moved in quick. They banged on the door, and Mike answers. He's shirtless and dazed. I mean, it was 6 a.m. after all. He just woke up. He's still recovering from his liposuction surgery. They quickly try to fill him in, and behind the police detectives, there's cameras and lights. It's the crew from the television show Cops, who'd been invited to come along and get the whole thing on camera to be used in their show. What was going through Mike Dippolito's head when all of this was happening on the other side of his door? He opens his door in the morning, probably expecting it to be his parole officer, maybe expecting it to be the police, maybe thinking he had gotten set up again. And there are cops there, but now they're telling him that his wife is trying to have him killed and he needs to get out of the house so they can set up a fake crime scene and trap her. Basically. Obviously, Mike was shocked and confused at first, but within a few moments, all the pieces of this jumbled puzzle began to vibrate together in his brain. The hell that he had been living in for months, everything had started happening when Dalia came into his life. She was the common denominator. The BBPD moved quickly, bringing Mike back to the station, quickly getting started on creating a crime scene while Dalia walked on the treadmill, killing time while she thought someone else was killing her husband. Premises were secured with yellow crime scene tape, the roads were even blocked off, and the cops crew were quickly escorted behind the police barrier so they wouldn't raise suspicions about being, you know, right with the cops when Dalia arrived. Two police officers had stayed on Dalia since she'd left that morning, And at 6:21 a.m., Detective Frank Ramsey called Dahlia's cell phone, but she didn't answer. He left her a message, he identified himself, and he told her to call him back. It was urgent. She quickly called back. She was told that the police were at her house. She needed to get back there as soon as possible. Ramsey told her there'd been an incident with her husband, and Dahlia asked if Mike was okay, and Ramsey repeated, she just needed to get back home now. He'd explain everything when she got there. So as soon as she gets back, she begins her acting. She looks confused, worried, as if she doesn't know what's going on, but she knows exactly what's going on. She's immediately brought over to Detective Ramsey, who has a lapel camera on, right? And the cop's cameraman behind the police tape, they're actively recording this as well. I'm going to play this video of Dalia Dippolito being notified that her husband is dead, and then we'll discuss. Now, I usually hate to look at people's reactions and decide whether they're wrong or right for the situation. Everybody handles things differently. Everybody reacts differently. But since we know, me and you, we know, Dalia was well aware of what was going on. We know she was faking the whole dramatic scene. I feel safe commenting. Many people believe she started wailing before Ramsey even said the word killed. This is up for debate, but you tell me what you see in here. I think that would be normal, even if she hadn't known. You know, he said that there'd been gunfire, and then he said, I'm sorry to inform you. So even in normal circumstances, someone may react before the whole word killed is out. Either way, in my opinion, if this was me, it wouldn't be the way that I would react, immediately dissolving into loud sobs. I'd be shocked. There would have to be some sort of transition period for your brain to comprehend what you're being told. There would have to be a point of denial, like, this can't be, or you must have the wrong person. Not for Dalia. She's immediately distraught. She starts asking to see her husband, who she was just told is dead. So she wants to see his dead body? I suspect she really did want to see him, if only to confirm that he was really dead. She was in the clear. Then, when she's asked if she knows anyone who would want to hurt him, she sobs out, he's on probation. Like, what does that even mean? Do you know anybody who would want to hurt him? He's on probation. The police officers, of course, they all know that this is fake. And for the most part, they do a good job of keeping the facade up, except for one detective who momentarily breaks character to turn his head and laugh because Dalia is going for a Meryl Streep like Oscar right now. Ramsey also mentions that neighbors saw a black male running away from the house, and does she know who that might be? She doesn't, but she keeps this little nugget of information in her head, and she'll bring it back up in a few minutes while she's being driven to the police station by two other police officers. In the police cruiser, during the 5-minute drive to the station, Dalia does not shut up. They aren't asking her questions, but she's offering up a ton of information. Now, this was recorded, but I don't have access to it, so I'll just act it out for you. Dalia speaks to the police officers driving her to the station in this little girl voice as she's crying. I don't believe it. I just want to grab my stuff, please. The police officer who's driving asks her, what stuff are you talking about? To which she responds, I want my bag. She's talking about her $3,000 Prada bag, which was in her car, which was already in the possession of the Boynton Beach Police Department. Inside the purse was every piece of pricey jewelry she owned, stuffed to the brim. $33,000 worth of jewelry, her $25,000 engagement ring, her burner phone, and keys to a safety deposit box that Mike hadn't known about. She had been worried about the hitman robbing them, So she'd taken measures to protect her most valuable possessions, and before she went to the gym, she just shoved her bag full of all her jewelry. So the officers tell her that they'll have someone bring it to the station for her because she's going to be there for a while. It's a little bit foreshadowing, I think he's doing. I don't know if he purposely did it, but ouch. Now, we know Dalia well enough by now, right? She's a flirt who thinks all men are stupid and powerless to her love, sex magic, her manipulation. This is a girl who most likely feels that men were put on the earth specifically to do her bidding. And she begins to try and sort of get information from the cops who are driving her to the station. Dalia says, "Can you please tell me what happened?" And the officer responds, "Well, we don't have all the details. We responded to a disturbance call. One of the initial reports said there were shots fired, like the sound of gunshots, and there was a black male. That's all we got." Dalia says, "What did the black guy look like?" Now she's trying to figure out if they've seen him, if somebody saw him, maybe her hitman will get caught up. Maybe he'll get, you know, captured by the police and then turn her in. And the officer responds, "He was dark. We don't have a description yet." And here Dalia starts to build a tale, and she says, "There have been a lot of black people that have been coming into the neighborhood, and normally Mike keeps a car cover on his Porsche. He hasn't had one on it, I don't know, the last month or something. And he's had someone who's been coming around saying, 'You've got a nice ride.'" That's not true. That's a lie. But the police officer, he's, you know, just trying to keep her talking or maybe shut her up. Who knows? But he says, "You've got to think about all of this stuff. All this stuff will help." Dalia responds, "He's had incidents already. We have. My husband's on probation, and he owed a lot of people money. And what happened was, he was trying to get off probation, and I guess some people found out he was trying to get off. And it's just been nothing but problems since." The police officer responds, "Just try to think of whatever you can." Dalia keeps going, and she says, "Well, I went to the police station because somebody had called my cell phone saying that they worked for your police department, that they were a detective. So I went and filled out a report. Me and my husband went together. And it turns out that there is no Detective Hurley here at the station." And the officer responds, "Hurley?" And she says, "Yeah, it was a detective. I have all the police reports and everything. Seems like somebody just spoofed the call. I don't know." Oh, you know. You know, Dalia. Once again, this is not how I personally would be acting if I just found out my husband had been shot to death. I can't say for sure what I'd be doing, but I know I wouldn't be turning into Veronica Mars trying to crack the case moments after being notified. Dalia goes on to tell them about all the times someone tried to set Mike up at the Ritz-Carlton, at City Place, the extortion letter, all the shady people Mike had business dealings with. She goes on to say, "And that's what he owes his business partner, $40,000. Referring to the amount requested in the extortion letter. And the officer asks her, "What type of business is he in?" And Dalia responds, "He got arrested for stock fraud, and now he's doing some internet thing. But he's been getting a lot of complaints lately, just because, you know, some things are wrong with what he's doing." The officer responds, "All this stuff is good. You give it to them when we get there." But Dalia doesn't stop there. In my opinion, if a police officer was saying this to me, I would shut up. I would take it as to mean like, okay, I'm not the person who's taking this report, so it doesn't do any good for you. Tell me this, just tell the people when we get there. But she goes on and she says, "When I tell you, I don't get in trouble or I'm responsible or anything like that, do I?" And the officer responds, "You're saying your husband is into some shady stuff. It's not your fault." Dalia begins crying again, and she asks if she can make a phone call with her cell phone. But then something strikes her that she thinks is odd. She takes a deep breath, and she asks, shakily, "How did you get my phone number?" The police officer, in a very quick save, he responds, "Off your husband's cell phone." And it seemed to satisfy her. Like, obviously, they had her cell phone number before that, but she didn't know how they'd gotten it. She is still thinking. She's not stupid. But what she is doing on this very short car ride is she's beginning to build her tower of lies, placing possible suspects in the minds of the police officers using the power of suggestion. Once at the police station, she's brought to an interview room where she first sits down with Sergeant Paul Sheridan. Now, the plan was to make her feel safe, let her play the victim a little bit longer. Maybe she'd give herself away or crack under the pressure and confess. Sheridan reads Dalia her Miranda rights, and he slides a paper over for her to sign, telling her that they're being videotaped and she needs to sign that, saying she understands. Now, she responds, "I don't want to be videotaped," but he says, "It doesn't matter. That's what's happening. You're being videotaped. I just need you to sign this paper so I know that you know what's happening.
First of all, let me just tell you, I'm sorry for your loss.
I just want to see my husband, please.
All right, honey.
I love my husband. I really love you, too.
No. You don't want to see him.
I just want to see him.
Believe me. You don't. No. Could you listen, please? I'm required to warn you before you make any statement that you have the following constitutional rights. And as I say, this is protocol. If you don't understand them, tell me you don't understand, I'll explain them to you, okay? This is something, because we're going to videotape, that I need you to sign also. It gives us the right to videotape it. You want to read that?
I don't want to be videotaped.
Well, you're being videotaped. That's all part of it.
Whose number is that?
That's your home number.
Oh.
This piece of paper was not what he said it was, however. Although they were recording her in the interview room, this piece of paper that she was signing was a release from the cops' television show. This lie, and that's exactly what it was, told by Sergeant Paul Sheridan, would come to be a thorn in the side of the lawyers that would later try Dahlia's case. The producer of the show, who was a man named Jimmy Langley, would later berate Sheridan for this and tear up the release that Dalia had signed, stating that it had been gained under false pretenses. Another member of the CAPS production team would later get Dalia to sign another one, explaining to her that they'd help her tell her side of the story. I'm not really sure if this was any more honest than Sheridan's approach, in my opinion, but okay. Once again, we go through the whole song and dance of Sheridan asking if there's anyone who might want to hurt her husband, and Dalia just shouting out immediately, he's on probation. And I mean, Dalia, like I said, she's not stupid. She is in some ways, but in others, she's pretty careful and strategic.
Listen, is there anybody that you know that you think would want to kill your husband?
He's on probation.
For what?
He's for stock fraud.
Stock fraud? How long have you been on probation? Probation or parole? Did you spend any time in prison? How much?
2 years in prison and 5 years on probation, going on to 6 years.
Oh my God. And what was that for?
It was for taking money. It was like, he explained it like boiler room kind of, where they would take money from people.
Oh, I understand.
Put it towards things.
Yeah. How long have you guys been married?
Not even a year.
She tells Sheridan just enough to raise suspicion of these sketchy associates that work with her husband and might have it out for him, but she doesn't say enough or give specifics so that she can't be caught in a lie. So she's not saying like, oh, it's this guy or this person or he looks like this or he works here. She's just a little girl who married the wrong guy. She doesn't know any names. She can't give details or descriptions. She does mention the name Pasquale, but she doesn't know his last name or what his relationship with Mike was.
What sort of problem?
He's been trying to get off probation.
Uh-huh.
And it's just been nothing but problems the whole time that he's been trying to get off. People weren't happy that he was getting off probation because it's a lot of money he's got to pay back.
Well, when you say people, who are you talking about? People that were involved with him before?
Just
or
a little bit of everything. This was supposed to be something, when he got off probation, it was supposed to be between us. And he went and he told, you know, friends of his, he told, you know, certain people, and everyone kind of talks, and he's constantly running into a lot of the guys that he was on probation with. Like, a couple days ago, we ran into someone, and that was a target. I mean, you know, and the guy comes up to us, and he's, like, with organized crime. It seems like a lot of the guys from Boca are starting to move up here, and we're constantly running into, you know what I mean, a lot of the guys that he knows and mm-hmm. things like that. So it was a lot of money. It was $191,000 that he had to pay back.
Now, do you know any of these people, their names or anything like that, or where they may live, so that we may be able to follow it up? We're not gonna implicate you.
The guys that left, I don't know.
Yeah, you don't know them?
I don't know them.
You never met them?
No, I mean, I know the guy that we ran into a couple days ago. Mm-hmm. I know certain names, you know what I mean? And I know certain families, they were on the news, like the guys that all just went away.
If you know any names, then we can run these guys down and see what they know.
Well, another group of guys, they all went away. But he's saying one of them, I guess somehow he had a problem. I don't know what problem he had. It was before we met. He ran into one of these guys, and the guy, he thought he owed him something or something happened. The one guy that I'm telling you about, mm-hmm. Pasquale, if he also went away or if he didn't. But this just happened like a month and a half ago. They all got arrested again, the same, the stock fraud stuff again.
Does his first name Pasquale or last?
I don't know.
Is it Pasquale or Pasquale?
Pasquale.
Sheridan sometimes tries to change the subject to more conversational matters. Once he asks her about her nationality, another time he tries to chat about her dogs, but she keeps steering him back to Mike's cloudy past and his connections with organized crime. She tells Sheridan that Mike lost all his money somehow, but he didn't know how to break that to his mother. So together, Mike and Dalia came up with an idea that they would tell everyone she'd gotten mixed up with some Bernie Madoff type scheme and lost it all. This is damage control in case the issue of the lost money ever comes up, in the case that the police talk to Mike's mom and she tells them that her son informed her his wife had lost all his restitution money. She's trying to get out in front of it. And Dalia did everything in this interview to make Mike look like a scumbag. He was on probation, he scammed people out of hundreds and thousands of dollars, he was an addict, so it was imperative that he stay on a routine. When Sheridan tells her that Mike was shot twice, Dalia does a great job of not being able to believe it. She tells Sheridan that they have cameras. Mike would never open the door for anyone he didn't know. But wait, wait. The cameras don't record. Oh, shucks. They wanted to have them record, but the company would have needed to drill a hole in the garage. And Mike didn't want that because he was worried about his Porsche. Dahlia's checking off all her boxes here. Criminal, drug addict, organized crime, shallow, materialistic, check, check, check. Sheridan leaves the room for a few minutes, telling Dalia that he has to call the cops who are still at the scene and see if they have any information. And while he's gone, Dalia puts her head on the table and sobs, putting on an act for the cameras that she was already told were watching and recording her.
somebody call out there and see if the place was burglarized.
I think
you're fine. Can you do that?
When Sheridan comes back, he tests the waters with Dalia a bit. He asks her, "You wouldn't want to kill your husband, would you?" And she launches into her routine, sketchy business partners, sketchy connections to organized crime. People were mad that he'd made a deal and gotten off easy and they got screwed, etc., etc. She then asks for water. And when Sheridan comes back with a bottle of water, his mannerisms are clearly different. I'm going to play that clip for you now.
Okay, the game's over with. Okay, there's no more games with you and I. Now we're going to get down to serious business. I want to know if you know this guy. Come here. Bring this guy in here. Get over here. Get over here. You know who this guy is?
No.
You've never seen him before?
I've never seen him before. Ever.
Do you know her?
Put your head up and look at her.
Put your head up.
I've never seen him.
What were you doing coming out of her house? Get him out of here.
So Sergeant Sheridan also has Witty Jean come in, still pretending to be the hitman, and he asks Dalia, like, do you know this guy? This would never happen in real life, according to Elizabeth Parker's book. And as we've seen in shows like Law & Order, Dalia might have been able to view a lineup or point out his picture in a book of photos, but he most likely wouldn't have been brought right into the room with her. I think this is when Dalia made the decision to just start denying everything. If she never owned up, never confessed, never claimed to know anything, she'd be safe. And she kind of gets this cue from Woody Jean because they ask him, like, do you know this woman? Have you ever seen her before? And he says, no. And she's like, okay, that's what we're doing. I got you. Now, after Woody Jean leaves, Sheridan tells her, it's over. You know, you're under arrest. We know everything. I have everything on tape. The gig is up.
You're going to jail today for solicitation of murder. You're under arrest. That's an undercover police officer. We filmed everything that you did, recorded everything that you did. You're going to jail for solicitation of first-degree murder of your husband.
I didn't do anything.
Did you hear what I just told you?
I heard what you said, but I didn't.
Listen to me. Everything has been recorded. You were photographed in the convertible when you sat in his car in the front of CVS. What do you want to do? What do you want to do here?
I didn't do anything.
Listen to me.
I didn't do anything.
You're going to
jail. I didn't do anything. Please, I didn't do anything.
Don't tell me you didn't do anything.
I didn't do anything.
You're going to jail today. As soon as I'm done, they're going to come in here and handcuff you and take you to the Palm Beach County Jail, book you for solicitation of first-degree murder on your husband.
I've watched this video of this happening several times, and each time I find myself being surprised how Dalia does not break. Even faced with video evidence, she denies everything, even when he quotes her directly from the video. She doesn't blink. And that's when he tells her Mike isn't dead. He's alive.
Your husband is well and alive.
Thank God.
Oh, yeah, thank God.
Can I see him?
No, he doesn't want to see you.
I'm so honored to see him.
Please. He doesn't want to see you.
Please.
You better quit your playing. Oh, listen to me.
Oh, my God.
I want you to quit your acting and get this over with.
I'm not.
Yes, you are.
I'm not.
Okay. You know what? You need a real good attorney. You need a real good attorney because we're going to show him the film where you say you're 5,000% sure you want him dead. You think I made that up?
So Sheridan wants to get her to talk, right? He'd ideally like a confession. And he keeps trying to get it from her, and he's like, oh, as soon as I walk out of here, like, it's over. Your chance, it's gone. I'm leaving. And he's messing with papers. You know, he's kind of speaking to her like a parent speaking to a child. Once I leave this room, there's no more chances. But he's obviously killing time before leaving the room. Like, what are you doing? The papers are shuffled.
When I leave this room, no other officer will ever talk to you again. The next time we see you is when you're in trial. Now, you can make it right here, or you're going to trial, and you're going to do life in prison. You want to cooperate with us, whatever you want to do. It's over and done once I walk out. I'm not coming back in to talk to you. And no one else is either. What do you want to do before I leave here? Because the next officer comes here, going to handcuff you and take you to the jail.
I can see my husband, please.
No, he doesn't want to see you.
You've shuffled the papers to death. And I wonder if Dalia noticed that he was kind of desperate to get her confession to the point where he was even like, he had his hand on the door and he's like, it's your last chance. I'm leaving, like walking slow motion.
You don't want to see it. I'm leaving now. Can I have an officer come in here and cuff this? The person.
I don't know what's going on, please.
So maybe she was like, okay, they don't have anything without my confession. Maybe that's why she felt emboldened to then ask to see her husband.
Oh my God.
She's alive.
Come here, please. Come here. Mike, come here. Come here, please. Come here.
Can't
fix
this.
Why not? I didn't do anything to
you. I heard you.
Mike, come here, please. Come here.
Okay.
And she keeps repeating over and over that she wants to see her husband. And she's doing this because she's had a 100% success rate of manipulating him in the past. She probably figured if he was the victim and she could convince him that she hadn't done this, there'd be no case. There'd be no crime if he wasn't going to press charges and she'd be free. Come here, Mike. Come here. Mike, come here. Almost commanding at times. It's very hard to watch. She wants him to walk towards her. She wants to have that physical touch and connection, knowing that it will cloud his mind and his judgment. And in my opinion, the actual torture and conflict is obvious in Mike's voice when he responds to her, right? This poor guy's been told by the police his wife wanted him dead. He already watched the videotape. It was played for him, where he was able to watch and hear her callously haggle with a hitman over the cost of his life. But he still isn't completely free of her spell. Later, he remarked on that moment saying, I wonder what would have happened if I'd grabbed her. That was my one chance. I probably should have taken it. I don't know if he means grab her to hug her or grab her to choke her. Maybe he wanted to do both. So Dalia is arrested, cuffed, and placed in a holding cell where she claims to have had some kind of panic attack. She was literally in there for less than an hour. That's it. But she had a panic attack, and the cops were great to her, right? They were really great to her. They gave her medical attention. They didn't make her use the toilet in her cell. They would let her go to the private bathroom. Much more consideration than she deserved, in my opinion. Dalia is brought back into the interview room for a second time, but this time, Sergeant Sheridan isn't there. It's two different detectives, Detective Moreno and Detective Anderson. Before they enter, she spends 4 minutes straight crying, dabbing at her eyes. And I do think that she was really crying at this point, right? She cries more realistically after finding out her husband is alive and they know what she did than she did when she thought he was dead. And when they do come into the room, they get right down to business. You know, they ask her if she understands what's happening. Does she understand that she's being arrested and why? And she has to go to the bathroom again.
Can I go to the regular restroom, please, before we start? Is that okay?
Is it an emergency?
I didn't feel comfortable going in the other one. I'm sorry.
No problem.
When she comes back, she claims no one ever told her what she was being charged with, and they have to go through all of it again. Detective Anderson says you attempted to hire someone to kill someone else, meaning your husband. That's why you're here, and that's what you're being charged with. And Dalia responds simply, no. And he's like, no, you don't understand? And she's like, no, that's not what happened. And watching the detectives in this room have this conversation with Dalia is like every single conversation I have with my three-year-old every day of the week. Like, Bella will wake up screaming in the middle of the night, right? I come running in. She's like, there's a monster. There's a monster in my room. And I'm like, no, there wasn't a monster in your room. And I'll bring her around her room, show her under the bed, show her in the closet. And I'll say, see, there's no monster. I have proof, evidence that there's no monster. And she'll be like, there's a monster. And I'll be like, where? What did it look like? What's your proof? And she's like, I don't have proof, lady. You just gotta trust me. There's a monster in here. And that's what Dalia is doing, right? They try to explain to her. They have the evidence. They're trying to give her the opportunity to come clean. She starts crying. She wants to talk to Mike. She wants to talk to her mom. She just wants to go home. The fact that she keeps asking them, can I just go home, clearly it blows my mind, first of all, because like you're under arrest for trying to have your husband killed. She lives in a world that is so far separated from actual reality.
Do you have anything to say about this?
I want to talk to my husband.
Okay, well, you can't talk to your husband. He's not here right now. I know it's hard, but...
You know, people make mistakes sometimes, you know? The good thing about this whole thing is that nobody got killed, all right? The gentleman that walked in the room, he said it's an officer, all right? This is not the first day we've been working this, all right? It's an ongoing investigation where we have you talking to this guy. We've listened to every conversation you had, all right? So now it's either, you know, tell the truth and do the right thing. That's, you know, that's what you want to reach inside you and you know, but we make mistakes. You know, everybody makes mistakes. What are you thinking?
Then I'd like to make a phone call. I just feel lost. I mean,
who do you want to call?
I have to call my mom.
We'll let you call your mom after this is done.
I mean, I'm not, you know, I just, everyone keeps coming and I'm signing all these things and going over all these things and I don't really know what they're for. I'm just signing it because everyone's saying, well, you know, if you sign this, I'll help you or will this or will that. And
I don't know about that, but the only thing we're concerned about is a rights card, and we went over it twice.
And he is where I came, and I guess that may have been for the release of the tape earlier. I don't know, because he never came back.
You got to understand this, okay? Donna, listen to me for a second, okay?
He didn't do anything.
Listen to me for a second, okay? This is not our first day, okay? It's not definitely not our second day, all right? This is an ongoing investigation, all right? Not only do we have your videotape, we have every conversation that you had leading to this point, all right? So for you to sit here and deny that you haven't done anything, it's not going to help, all right? Because we know the whole story from the beginning to the end to this point that we're right here right now, all right? Every little thing that you've done since this started, we've been involved in it, okay?
I'm not trying to
undermine you. I'm just telling you the truth. That's the truth.
All right?
Well, unfortunately, you're not going home, okay? You're looking at some serious charges here. Do you understand that you made the attempt to hire somebody to kill your husband? That's how serious this is. Okay, you can sit here and shake your head and deny it, but I'm going to tell you right now, all right, when the jury and the judge sees that videotape of you having this conversation, making a deal, all right, that's how far you went, all right? It's not about denying it wasn't me, I didn't do anything, because the video, the audio, it's not going to lie, all right? And all the evidence that we have collected throughout this investigation.
You sound like a fool right now denying this, because like my partner just said, everything's on tape, video and audio.
I
know, but you're not going home, you see? You're being arrested, so you're not going home.
But what do I have to do to go home? It's
like
to go home.
I know, but you can't. It's impossible. You're going to the Palm Beach County Jail after this. You can't go home. You're being arrested. This is just a game. In your mind, it might be a little game, but this is very, very serious. Murder? Are you kidding me?
And it seems like she wants to do everything but tell the truth. So they play her the video of her hiring a hitman. And I don't have this part on videotape, but it's in the transcripts. And so she requests to hear it, and it's just the audio, and she listens to it. And then they're like, okay, so you understand now? And she's like, no, I don't understand at all. That's not me. I didn't do that. So then they show her like the video where it's her, and she's like, no. And then she asks to see the video again. So they ask her specifically, like, is that you on this tape? And she's like, well, can you play the video for me again? And they're like, I mean, I guess, but like, is it you or is it not you? And she gets petulant, like an angry child, and she kind of sulks like this. And she's like, well, fine, don't play it again. I just wanted to see if I could see it again. But if you don't want to play it again, you don't have to play it again. Fine. Like, real pouty. She does see the video. They played it for her. But to Dalia, it's not enough. She knows that she never specifically said, hey, would you kill my husband? She also knows no money exchanged hands, at least between her and the alleged hitman. So she's just going to take her chances with her denying method. After going in circles for a bit, they ask her, why did you want to kill your husband? And she says, I never said I wanted to kill my husband. And it's almost comical at some point to hear them telling her, like, we have you on tape. We hear you. We see you saying it. And for her to just keep saying, nope, it wasn't me. At one point, she says, I didn't. And one of the cops says, you did. It's on tape. A lot. So her attempt at gaslighting, it doesn't end with the police officers. After Dalia is processed, she makes 4 phone calls. The first 3 calls are to her mother, Rhonda. Her 4th and final call was to Mike Dippolito. Now I'm going to play some of this for you. Some of Rhonda's call and then Mike's call. So here's the call with Rhonda, and then we'll discuss.
Hello? Mom, I'm in jail.
I know, Dalia. I know. I find out.
I need you to call Mike in New York.
Okay, who do you want me to call?
I need you to call Mike in New York, please.
I call already, and I call that. Everybody knows. What is it you want me to do? Where are you exactly?
I'm in the county jail. I need you to call. What did Mike say? Is he coming?
Everybody's coming, Dalia. We're going to go ahead and get your lawyers, okay? Don't worry. Don't worry. Where are you? Are you in Gunclub?
Yes, I'm here, Mom. Mike said this to me.
Okay, Dalia.
I didn't do anything.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and get...
They showed me pictures. They showed me a tape, Mom. I did not do anything. Nothing.
How did they set you up like that?
I did not do anything.
Okay, all right, I understand. We're going to go ahead and get a lawyer, okay?
But what did Mike say?
Mike is coming, Dad is coming, everybody is aware, okay? I'm going to go ahead and get in touch with you, all right? I'm going to find, where are you? You in Gun Club?
Yes, I'm here, I'm in Gun Club, and I heard Mike is at the house. I want him out of my house.
Okay, well, right now we're going to need to have a lawyer first, okay?
That's my house, the title's in my name.
All right, okay, don't worry about that right now. Right now we need to find out what is going on. Where did it happen? Where?
Where is it? What happened?
It happened this morning.
This morning, Mom. I was at the gym this morning. I got a phone call from a detective. The detective told me to come to the house. I came running to the house. There was tape everywhere. The door was open, and they told me that Mike was dead. And they told me that I couldn't see him. I couldn't see the dogs. I couldn't see anybody. They said to me, please, I wanted to call you. I wanted to call his mom. I wanted to call everybody, and they told me no.
They told you that Mike was dead?
Yes. They told me Mike was dead.
How come they saying that you met somebody in the gas station?
No, they told me Mike was dead. They were at my house this morning. And then I left with the officers to help them try to prove it.
How many times did I told you to leave that guy? How many times did I tell you that, Dalia? Okay, I understand. All right, well, I'm taking care of it, okay? Everybody's coming. Everybody's coming now, Dalia. Okay, bye.
Now remember, Dalia calls Rhonda before she calls Mike. And in the call to her mother, she's like, I want that man out of my house. That's my house. It's in my name. And I want him out. And she also tells her mother, call Mike in New York and get him here. Now, she's not talking about Mike Dippolito, right? Mike Dippolito's not in New York. He's in Florida, in her house. So she's asking Rhonda to call Mike Stanley. So Rhonda knows Mike Stanley, knows about him, and knows that her daughter and Mike still talk and clearly knows how to get a hold of him. Now here's the call between Dalia and Mike, and my favorite part about this, I love Mike Dippolito, I have to admit, he cracks me up, I think he's a funny guy. He would have been great on a reality TV show, actually, but when she calls him, he picks up, and she's like, hey, and he's like, oh, hey, like, she's just calling him on a regular sort of day.
Hello. Yeah, what's up?
Nothing, Mike, can you please come here?
Hey, listen, I'm not, I don't want to fight with you. Honestly, I can't help you. Don't you understand what just happened?
What they're saying is not true.
How is that possible?
Like, I'm sitting here. It's not true. It's not possible. You wouldn't even give me 2 minutes to talk to you, but it's not possible. What they're saying is not true.
How in the hell did I hear it and see it?
Like, I heard what you heard. It's not true. I heard what you heard and I saw what you saw. Everything they showed you, they showed me.
And how is it not, how are you telling me that?
I am giving you my word that it's not true.
Dalia, I couldn't help you if I wanted to.
Mike, please, I need an attorney. Can you please help me? It's not true.
Your brother was here and I spoke to him. And he's going to go talk to your mom. I called them for you already, right?
Mike,
so everybody... Everybody knows where you're at. I took care of it.
I know that. I need your help, okay? This is not true.
I understand it, too. Like, how do you explain what I saw and heard?
Like, I am limited on my phone call. You know more than anybody. It's not true. Just give me time so I can talk to you.
What did it say? I saw it. I heard it.
I saw what you saw, and I heard what you heard.
Okay, what the f***? You said you wanted to have me killed. I heard that.
That's not true. That is not true.
How is it not true?
How can you believe that?
I heard your voice.
How can you believe it?
That isn't the point. I heard you say it.
It's not. I heard what you heard, and it's not.
What did I hear then? I heard you say.
I heard the tape. Okay, I heard the tape, and I saw pictures, and I saw the whole 9 yards. I saw all of it.
So why would you meet a black guy in a parking lot? Explain that.
I'm sitting here on the phone. I will tell you when I see you in person. Please.
I can't come there anyway. I'm not allowed there.
That's not true. Who said that? They tell you that on purpose.
I don't know what you could tell me, even if, let's pretend, I said, oh, it's all better. I can't, they're charging your ass. Don't you get it?
Like, I didn't do anything. Please.
I don't know what to say to you. I can't help you.
What do you mean?
It's out of my hand.
You're not even trying.
What am I supposed to do?
I'm supposed to have an attorney, please, so I can talk to you.
You know, one thing after another, you can't explain this one, you know? Come on, man. What do you mean you didn't dare him? You met a guy in a parking lot.
You knew me, okay? You needed me yesterday. I took you right before Lauderdale because of your thing, because of this, because of that. Every time you need me, I am here for you. Every single time, and there's no denying that.
So why would you meet a guy in a parking lot and hand him $1,200 and say, yes, I want him dead?
I didn't give anybody $1,200. Period. Where they got that from, I have no idea. I never gave anybody money. I never paid anybody money. I never anything. Nothing of nothing, and you have my word. Nothing.
I saw you with this guy in the truck or whatever the f*** it was. I saw it. I heard your voice clearly. I don't understand.
I did not say those things. Period.
So how did they get your voice on that tape recorder?
Like, I'm limited with my time, please. Okay, can you please help my mom? Please.
Is she going to call me?
No, why would she call you? Call my mom.
I did call her already. I spoke to her, and she didn't believe anything I said, and I didn't say anything bad.
Because you didn't want to help her. I already talked to my mom. You didn't offer to help her. You just said, okay, well, you know, whatever.
You gotta be kidding me, man. Look, Dalia, I heard you say that shit.
Like,
okay?
I'm telling you right now, okay?
You can't fix this. You don't listen to me. You need to get your lawyer. Your mom's going to get you. I spoke to your brother. And you need to just handle it. Because, Dalia, listen, if I go screaming to the judge or whatever I say, oh, it's okay, they're charging your ass.
Like, it doesn't matter, period.
It doesn't matter. You can hire 5 lawyers. They're charging your ass. They have your voice, your face, everything on tape. You're in a lot of trouble. I'm trying to help you.
Are you trying to help me? How? How?
Because I'm trying to get your head get off the bullshit and understand what's going on here.
What bullshit would that be?
That is,
I'm sitting here. My
how are you going to sit there and tell me that? How are you going to tell me that you didn't say it, you didn't do it? When I saw you say it, and I saw you do it.
Do you have any idea how I was when they told me what supposedly happened to you, how I got, and how I was, and how everything?
Right, and you wanted me 500 or 5,000% dead.
That's not true.
You're absolutely
that's
sure,
not
right?
True. I heard what you heard, and that's not true.
And what did you hear then?
I heard the 5,000% sure. I heard, what else did I hear? I heard the whole thing. Everything you heard, I heard. And
well,
not once.
What are you disputing about it?
I never wanted to dead, period. Can you meet me in person so I can talk to you?
No.
Why?
Explain that to me right
why?
Now.
Why?
Why should I?
Because you know me. Okay, whenever you need me, I am there for you, period. You couldn't even get off the couch the other day, and I came, and I brought you dinner, and I this, and I that, and I always make sure you're always taken care of. You're always everything. I never, ever, 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 ever in my wildest dreams ever want that for you, ever say anything, period. I didn't say anything.
I heard you.
I didn't say anything. I heard what you heard, and it didn't say
that. What the f***? I heard you say it. How did you not hear it? I mean, how did you not hear it? I heard you. I heard you. I saw you. I saw it. I heard it. I don't understand what you're arguing with me about. And where were those two safety deposit keys? What are they to? My money?
No, it's the papers. What are you talking about?
The keys they found in your purse. Was that where my money's hiding right now?
No, they're just regular papers.
No, they were safety deposit keys. I know what they look like.
Right, and it's got papers. That's it.
Well, listen. I don't know how you're going to actually have the nerve to sit here and lie to me now. I don't understand. Like, I heard you say it, Dalia. I saw your mouth do it. I can't help you even if I wanted to. Do you get it?
Why don't you want to?
It's out of my hands.
You're not even trying. It's different if you're trying. You're not even trying.
What could I possibly do for you? I don't get it. What could I do?
You're not even trying.
Trying what? I'm sitting here like a dumbass.
Okay, they're getting ready to, like, take me again.
Dalia, I'm gonna give you some advice, and you need to listen. You're gonna be ran around in there for a little while, a couple days. You need to just try and relax, and just go with it. And keep to yourself, and don't say a lot.
I think I love you, don't do this to me. I'm sitting here, everybody treated me awful, sir. I can't do anything to you. You know me. Everyone do the same awful to me.
I can't help you. There's nothing I can do to help you.
Hello?
Yeah. You know what I'll do? You know what I'll do for you? Seriously?
What?
You sign my house back over to me. I'll help your mom immensely. Give me my house back so I don't have to go through the legal bullshit I have to go through already.
What does that mean?
It means sign my property back to me that you stole, basically.
That's what you're thinking, and I didn't steal anything.
All right, so listen. I'll have the papers sent over to you somehow. You'll sign them over to me, and then I will help your mother. Okay?
I'm not signing anything.
I know you wouldn't sign anything. I knew that wasn't going to happen. So I can't help you. Okay?
That's what you're thinking about. I'm sitting here rotting and you're thinking about.
Yeah, you tried having me killed.
That's not true.
You're a f***ing liar. You're a f***ing liar. I can't fix it. I just offered to help you, and again, you have the balls to say no to me. Okay? But I can't help you.
How do I believe you're going to help me if I do that?
Because you know why? Because I'm the only person on the phone that's ever done what they said they were going to do. Me. Okay?
How do I believe that?
Don't say shit. I just said I'd help you. Okay? You just basically said you to me, which is hilarious considering your situation and considering what the just happened today. Have your mom call me. I'll talk to her about it. I told you what I do. I'll fix it. I'll help you. You got to do the right thing.
Okay, so in this call with Mike, she gaslights the shit out of him, right? It's actually the most impressive display I've seen in a while. I saw what you saw, I heard what you heard, but it's not true. And she does this for almost the entire 11-minute call. She's trying to manipulate him, prey on that sliver of doubt in him, hoping that she can get him there in person so she could reel him back in. Remember when Mike broke up with her after their Vegas trip, and then they met for coffee a few months later for closure? It's the same situation. Dalia had a bag full of tricks, and she was confident enough in her physical appearance and her expertise in the art of seduction to the point that she truly felt if she could just get him alone, she would be walking out of that police station. She would have him believe that she'd been framed or it was a mistake, and none of that video evidence was true. During the whole call, he seems to be really wanting to believe that she's telling the truth. She's telling him, like, this isn't what it looks like. Come here, I'll explain it to you. And he's like, but what else could it be? You know, but I know this feeling. I've been there before. You just really want to believe that this person you love and trusted and gave yourself to is being honest with you. But when he asks her to sign his house that he paid for back over to him, and then he'll help her, she refuses. You can almost hear the doubt dissipate in his voice. And even then, he still seems to care about her. He gives her advice about being in prison. He's like, keep your head down, don't say anything, try to stay busy, because he has experience from being on the inside himself. So even though he knows, saw with his own eyes and heard with his own ears that this woman tried to have him killed, he was still willing to help her, and even just to give her advice on how to survive in prison. Later, when Mike was asked why he answered the call, he responded, how could I not answer the phone? I had to take that call. In my mind, I'm thinking any normal person would be honest, give me some truth, but she gave me the opposite, all lies. I couldn't believe she called me, to be honest with you. I was probably her third call. Then she's calling me at what she's telling people is her house. When I met her, she had a bag of clothes. If she'd done the right thing, I would have helped her, just to be done with her. The same day that Dalia was arrested, later that afternoon, the Boynton Beach Police Department posted the video of Dalia being notified on YouTube. It went viral, and it was featured on Nancy Grace the very next day. I'm not sure what the police department was thinking, honestly. If they thought the case was a slam dunk, maybe they thought she would confess, maybe they thought they had enough evidence, they wouldn't even need to go to trial. But I mean, that video was technically evidence in an ongoing investigation, and having that video be so public, it would surely taint a jury pool within no time. Dalia spent the night in jail, and the next day she appeared before a judge to determine if she was a flight risk and how much her bail would be. She was released on $25,000 bond and was allowed to await her trial on house arrest. So she moved into her mother's house and spent her days lounging by the pool. Pretty tough. That poor girl, she had it hard, man. She was given an ankle monitor, but she was only allowed to leave to go to work or church because she was such a huge churchgoer before. According to Elizabeth Parker's book, Mike Dippolito was uncomfortable with Dahlia's release, considering that Rhonda's house was less than a mile away from his, and Dalia didn't really work, did she? The only sale she'd ever made as a real estate agent was the house that she'd sold to her husband that she later stole from him. The court agreed to monitor Mike's usual locations, home, the gym, Starbucks, and if Dalia entered into any of these zones, if her ankle monitor was seen entering any of these zones, she'd be immediately taken in and be in violation of her parole. So Mike did agree to let Dalia come and grab her stuff, though. He went through their townhouse, boxing it all up, shoving memories of her and them into cardboard boxes that he would place in her car for her to retrieve later. It might have been harder to go through this process if Mike hadn't found tampons stuffed into every open crevice of the house. Used tampons that Dalia had hidden away to keep her pregnancy story going. This was the first time Mike realized, for sure, that Dalia was not really pregnant with his child, and it was kind of the straw that broke the camel's back. While Dalia is on house arrest, the state begins to build its case against her. They get access to her safety deposit box, they request phone records, bank records, internet search histories. Inside the safety deposit box, they found a bank statement for an account that Dalia had set up without Mike's knowledge using her mother Rhonda's address. This gave them the reason to obtain a search warrant for Rhonda's house, and also led them to a storage unit that Dalia had been renting but had stopped making payments on. Now, Mike knew about the storage unit. He said that's where they kept their bikes, and Dalia also kept a big duffel bag there. By the time the police got to the storage unit, they were informed that Rhonda had just been by, and the duffel bag was gone. So their next step was Rhonda's home. When they arrived, they saw Dalia rifling through this very same duffel bag. Inside were photographs and client lists from her old days as a call girl. They took the bag from her, they made copies of everything, and on one of these lists, and on one of these like client lists, they found many men that they called and got some more information. It appeared she had quite a bit of clients all over the U.S., many of them in Washington, D.C., and it also appeared that while being married, she was still seeing some of these clients on the side. In fact, She'd had an appointment booked for the day after she'd been arrested. They also found Mike Stanley through these records, and Mike Stanley was never charged with any crime during this case. But I have to believe if they'd searched harder, if they'd pushed him a little more, if they really wanted to get him on something, they could have found something to stick. In a way, I feel bad for him, just another guy that got left in her wake, but I also believe that people are responsible for their own actions and decisions, and he certainly helped and assisted Dalia in scamming Mike for some time. Something should have happened to him, in my opinion. After Dalia was arrested, he sent her flowers in prison, he gave her mother Rhonda money to help out. Did he know that Dalia had been lying to him about everything? Had Dalia really lied to him about everything? Did he not care, regardless of the circumstances? Did he know everything and he was just protecting her? I couldn't tell you. I think only two people know, Dalia and Mike Stanley. And Mike Stanley has since passed, and we know that Dalia's not talking. Now on to the trial, the first trial. Dalia was represented by a man, a lawyer, named Michael Selnick. And I'm not trying to personally attack anyone, and I know it's your job when you're a defense lawyer to defend people who are sometimes guilty, but this is the kind of guy we're working with. He was the defense lawyer for a man who was arrested for starving his 16-month-old baby daughter to death. The first trial would last for 3 weeks, 1 week on, 1 week off, and 1 week back on. There were 6 jurors, 4 women and 2 men, and Dahlia's defense was once again unbelievable, like everything else in her life. Michael Selnick went into this trial with the allegation that Dalia had not planned to hire a hitman to kill her husband, but that Mike Dippolito, a shallow, fame-hungry man who had an unending appetite for reality TV, he'd made her do it, and he'd concocted the whole plan to create a media event that would go viral and get him a spot on a reality television show. Selnick claimed Mike loved to watch these kinds of shows. Jersey Shore was his favorite, but he also liked Cheaters, a hidden camera type show where one partner believes the other is cheating and sets them up to catch them in the act on camera. Mike had actually bought Dalia the box set of Cheaters for Christmas, and he even got her a matching tank top to wear while they were watching. Now, Mike did dispute this, well, part of it. He said, yeah, he really did like the Jersey Shore. I mean, who didn't? But Cheaters was more of Dahlia's thing, which is why he'd gotten the DVDs and the tank top for her. And Michael Selnick, Dahlia's lawyer, was focused on, you know, pretty much one thing, which was to make Mike Dippolito look like the scummiest person in the world. He would bring up his criminal past at every chance he got, making sure to paint him as a con artist, a thief, and a callous individual who was supposed to be paying his victims restitution, but instead did all he could to hide his cash so that he wouldn't have to pay it off. Selnick accused Mike of lying about everything. Dalia hadn't stolen his money. He'd given it to her to hide in her bank account, and they'd both used it to fund their lavish lifestyle. To Mike's credit, he was a trooper on the stand, and even though there is clear tension between Mike Dippolito and Michael Selnick, Mike Dippolito tries to keep a sense of humor, and I'm much of the same. The situation he found himself in was obviously in no way funny, but sometimes when things are too heavy, too much to process, it seems more bearable if you can laugh about it. And I think that's what he was doing here. Check out this video.
When you say it's a weird guy, that implies one thing.
He's weird because he wouldn't stop looking over at us, you know? If you were staring at me, I'd think you were a weird guy.
Okay. Well, I'm staring at you now, so am I weird?
No, you're like a parrot.
A parrot?
Yeah.
What does that mean? I've been called a lot of things. What's a parrot?
You know. Come on.
You're winking at the judge. He doesn't know what you mean. What do you mean?
Did you do that on probation? Were you on probation? Did you do that on probation? Were you on probation? You know what I'm talking about. I'm just having fun with you. Come on. I'm with you.
You having fun with me? Let me ask you something. Is this fun, Mr. Dippolito?
This sucks.
Okay. Was it fun when you got arrested?
No.
Was it fun when you went through court?
Horrible.
Okay. So, is there anything funny about this proceeding at all, Mr. Dippolito?
The questions you're asking me, some of them, yeah.
You don't like them, do you?
It's ridiculous. We're not here because of me. Well, you might as well put me up next. I mean, what are we doing here?
Well, wait a minute, Mr. Dippolito. You started it. You're a prosecution witness, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you took an oath to tell the truth, right?
Yes.
And when you were placed on probation,
Again?
You are presumptively telling the truth, right?
Yes.
But you've admitted that you're a liar, haven't you?
Yeah, I've been dishonest. Yes.
Not just when you committed your crime. Crimes. But while you're on probation, too. You're lying to your probation officer like it's nothing.
Okay.
Is that... No, not okay. I guess it's okay with you to lie to your probation officer. But my question is that something you don't take serious either?
I take it very serious.
Obviously.
And I don't blame Mike Dippolito for clapping back. He wasn't perfect. He had a sketchy past, and I do think that he was definitely trying to hide money so that he wouldn't have to pay back the restitution all at once, but he wasn't the one on trial. The only reason they all had to be there was because of Dalia. And yeah, he'd done bad things, but he hadn't hired someone to kill someone else. Why should he be dragged through the mud when in this case, he hadn't done anything wrong? And even during the trial, which is 2 years after Dahlia's arrest, Mike still refers to her as my wife, which I think says something about his heart and how much he truly did care about Dalia. When he was questioned during the trial, he was able to still recall the good that Dalia had done for him, how he'd been a structured creature of habit, but when he met her, she forced him outside of his box and made him try things he normally wouldn't have done, like riding a roller coaster. So let's keep in mind here, this is the first time the whole reality TV show thing comes up. It's never been talked about before, especially by Dalia. It's not mentioned in any texts between Dalia and Mike Dippolito or Mike Stanley or Mohammed or anyone. She doesn't mention it when she's in the car with the cops being driven to the station, nor when she's getting questioned by the police at the station, nor when she calls Mike from jail begging with him to help her. So it truly was just a fabricated defense meant to distract and defy reality, just as reality television is actually intended to do. Because you'd think, if that was the truth, and you got arrested, when the cops are like, you killed your husband, we know you did, she'd be like, no, that was an act, like, we're just trying to get on reality TV. Nothing, she doesn't do that at all. So I don't believe it. During the trial, Dahlia's mother, Rhonda, also testified. Now, she was mainly questioned about certain Google searches done on Dahlia's computer in the week before she was arrested. It seems that someone used Dahlia's computer, which was password protected, and had looked up Boynton Beach funeral homes, crematoriums, and can you beat an anabolic steroid test. Now, this search happened the same day Dalia had met with Witty Jean, a man she believed to be a killer, a man she had pointed in the direction of her husband, and that same day she's looking up funeral homes. On the stand, Rhonda claimed that her father, Dalia's grandfather, was very ill, and she knew it was time to start thinking about funeral arrangements, so she'd had Dalia do some research for her. When pressed by Elizabeth Parker about when exactly this search had been done, and if Rhonda had talked to Dalia before or after asking her to do the search, Rhonda's memory failed her, and eventually she resorted to screaming and sobbing on the stand, yelling that Parker was showing no respect for Rhonda's father, who actually had died shortly after Dalia was arrested. The crematorium that Rhonda had decided to go with did appear on a list of Google searches on Dahlia's computer, but the website itself for that specific place, it had never been accessed. But something about the relationship between Rhonda and Dalia gives me pause, and I have to wonder how much this woman knew and participated in Dahlia's actions. Rhonda told the court that she and Dalia had been incredibly close, but when Mike came along, all that changed. Suddenly, Dalia and Mike were always together, they were always rushing off somewhere, and Rhonda also claimed she hadn't liked Mike since the moment she'd laid eyes on him, saying he had a nervous tic and a fake smile. She said, quote, "As soon as I saw him, me as a mom felt something. I don't know, some kind of feeling. He wouldn't look in my eyes." Mike, of course, listening to this testimony, was shocked. As far as he knew, his wife's mother liked him, and they'd always had a friendly relationship. He often took them all out to dinner, and they would tease each other like old friends. And it really doesn't seem, if you believe Mike's surprise, that Rhonda ever let on to Mike that she wasn't his biggest fan, and this may be where Dalia gets her two-faced personality from. Remember the lawyer who was helping Mike with his administrative probation? The guy who wasn't a lawyer at all, but just Mike Stanley following Dalia's bidding? He had told Mike to drop off his paperwork to a paralegal waiting on the Miami courthouse steps, but if he wasn't a real lawyer, was that guy a real paralegal? Nope. On July 22nd, Dalia texted her mother saying, "Need someone professional to meet me and Mike at the Miami courthouse in 2 and act like a legal secretary and take a paper from us. I just need them to say they are taking it to an attorney and thanks for meeting with him. The lawyer was in depositions all day. I'll pay them $500. Anyone else would have been like, "Okay, I'd love to help you, but what's this about?" But Dahlia's mother, Rhonda, responded, "What lawyer are they representing? And what happens to the papers after? Are they talking to anyone besides you and Mike?" Dalia responds, "Me and Mike are giving them papers. They can trash them later. Let me know if you have someone who looks professional." And Rhonda responds, "Okay, I've got a guy. Give me all the details, including address and what is the lawyer's name." And Dalia says, "Does he look professional?" And Rhonda responds, "Yes, he will." She never asks questions. She never wants the detail. She just acts as if this kind of thing is a commonplace request from her daughter. Rhonda, acting as the go-between, enlisted a man from her church named Sergio Calderon, and he wasn't a paralegal. He was a luggage salesman from Colombia. Sergio would testify at the trial and say that after he'd collected the papers from Mike, he'd called Rhonda and she'd instructed him to throw them away. Now, Rhonda's involvement makes sense somehow, because I remembered hearing a story about how when Dalia was a madam, she and her grandmother used to go and bring food to the girls that worked for Dalia. I think her family knew what kind of antics she was up to and what kind of antics she'd always been up to. I think they may have been complicit, if not involved, allegedly. Don't come for me. Before Dalia had texted her mom for help that day, she'd been a very busy bee. Here are the texts she sent at 8:15 a.m. on the 22nd to Mike Stanley. "Hey, baby, what's the earliest you can make the call? I want to prep you before you talk to him. Call my other phone with the spoof. He wants to drop the paper. Tell me tomorrow. Call me now, please, with the spoof 561 number." And it appeared that Mike Stanley hadn't only played the part of a lawyer, he was also a successful OBGYN, with texts from Dalia to him on July 17th saying, "Need you to call me and act like Doc. Just ask me why I didn't come and how I'm feeling." Stanley responds, "Okay, I will call from a private number in 15 minutes. And Dalia says, "Do you know how to spoof call?" And Stanley responds with question marks and said, "Pretend to be Doc?" And Dalia said, "In 2 minutes, call the other phone. Yes, Dr. Emmerich, pretend to be proper." And Stanley responds, "I'll try." Now, once again, Mike Stanley, who should be a science fiction author, comes up with a great excuse of why he's not responsible for these calls. He claims that it wasn't him, but it was his buddy, Joe, from the neighborhood deli, who had made the call to Mike pretending to be a lawyer. Mike Stanley also claimed he doesn't know what Joe said to Mike Dippolito on the phone because he took the phone and walked into another room. But according to Mike Stanley, all he did was hand the phone to Joe from the deli and told him to give Mike legal advice. Now, I'm not sure why Joe from the deli around the corner would be qualified to give legal advice, but okay. That's what Mike Stanley says. Mohammed was asked to testify, but he was planning on leaving the country, go back to his home country. His mother was really sick, and life for him hadn't been great since Dalia had been arrested. Same day she got arrested, Larry Coe confronted Mohammed and called him a snitch. Florida wasn't looking like a good option with the Buck Wild gang around. Mohammed said he thought he'd already be gone, left, you know, the country by the time of this trial. So Elizabeth Parker and Michael Salnick interviewed him on camera, the same way they would in court, so it could be played for the jury at a later date. Somehow Mohammed had been pulled into this whole reality TV story along with Mike Dippolito, and Salnick would tell the jury that he was the one who had experience with acting because he was on Burn Notice like 12 years ago, and all three of them were trying to make it big. That 30-minute meeting between Dalia and Mohammed's at the Chili's, the one that hadn't been recorded because of equipment malfunction, Dalia claimed that during that time, he'd threatened her life and her family's life because she went there to tell him she was out. She wasn't going through the plan now. It was getting too serious. The police were involved. She didn't want to do it anymore. And Mohammed was like, "Oh yeah, you're gonna do it. You're gonna do it, or I'll kill you and your family." Essentially, that's what she claims. Michael Salnick would allege that this was the reason. This was the real reason that Mohammed had come along to the meetup up with Witty Jean, not to be a supportive friend, but to make sure that she went through with it. Michael Salnick also went as far as to accuse the Boynton Beach Police Department of having this footage of their meeting at Chili's, but destroying it because it didn't support their narrative. During the trial, a woman named Stephanie Slater testified. Now, she was the Boynton Beach Police Department's public information officer, and she also had a background in journalism. Her job was to make sure the BBPD always looked good and would occasionally get some positive press. Now, Salnick wanted the jury to believe that the wrong person was on trial, right? Dalia wasn't the villain. She was the victim, the innocent, naive young woman who had been used and manipulated by everyone around her, Mike Dippolito, Mohammed, and the Boynton Beach Police Department. According to Stephanie Slater, the police department's involvement with the television show Cops started in September of 2008 when she reached out to Brian Collins, a producer of the show, on the request of the chief of police. Now, Cops had recently done ride-alongs with the Palm Beach and Martin County police forces, and Boynton Beach wanted their piece of the pie. In April of 2008, Cops spent a week with the BBPD to see if it was a good fit, and it went so well, they requested a total of 8 weeks with the police officers that would start on August 11th, 2009. According to Slater, the Cops producers were the ones who had moved this date from the 11th to the 2nd of August, when they would start with the police force. On that same day that Cops showed up, Sergeant Sheridan approached Stephanie Slater and suggested it might be a good idea if the film crew followed them along with the Dippolito case. It was set to go down in just a couple of days, and both Slater and Sheridan figured that since the crime was already committed, recording her arrest or recording her being notified at the fake crime scene, it wouldn't be a conflict or issue with a potential trial. Slater then went up the chain of command to get approval, but where she messed up a little bit, in my opinion, was posting that video on YouTube within hours of everything going down. When asked if she thought that it was a good idea, she claimed that it had happened on a public street where there was no expectation of privacy and anyone could have recorded and posted that footage, so why not the BBPD? Frank Ramsey, the detective who had notified Dalia of her husband's fake murder, also took the stand. His being put on the stand was so they could introduce the video as evidence in the trial, but he gave his opinion that from his vantage point, Dalia was not crying real tears. He called her performance an Academy Award winning act of grief, and Salnick jumped at these words that Ramsey chose to use. He probed a bit, saying it seemed like Dalia reacted before she'd even heard the word killed, kind of like she was faking it, and Ramsey agreed to this and said in his opinion her reaction was fake. If this doesn't make sense to you, it will in a second. So Detective Anderson was put up next, and Salnick asked how many times could Anderson remember Dalia asking to see her husband, to which Anderson responded once or twice. Salnick followed up with telling Anderson that, according to his own words, he'd indicated Dalia had a lack of emotion in the interrogation room, as if she wasn't very upset about her husband being dead, and Anderson confirmed this. Salnick said, well, what if she knew he wasn't really dead? Wouldn't you expect her to have a lack of emotion? To which Anderson responded, if she knew that. Salnick continued, asking Anderson, you said there were no tears. In other words, it was sort of like acting or fake crying. Anderson responded, fake crying, yes. And Salnick asked Anderson to show the jury exactly how one might fake cry, which Anderson did, and Dalia laughed out loud from her place at the defendant's table. Salnick keeps going, putting an emphasis on the word acting, because he wants Anderson to admit that Dalia was acting, which he thought would somehow prove his case that she was just following orders from two toxic males to get noticed for a reality show. Salnick was trying to convince the jury that the reason her crying was fake, the reason she didn't behave normally, was because she knew Mike was alive the whole time, and she was just acting. At one point, Salnick says to Detective Anderson, you don't want to use the word acting, do you? And Anderson responded, why wouldn't I want to use the word acting? And Salnick tries again, well, was she acting like she was crying? And Anderson responds, she was faking like she was crying. So I like how much Salnick gets messed with by the people on the stand in this case. It was just very amusing to me. It made the trial incredibly interesting to listen to. So Michael Salnick spent the whole trial attempting to make Mike look like a guy from the wrong side of the tracks, battering on the BPPD for being fame hungry and setting Dalia up to achieve their 5 minutes of it. There were so many holes in Salnick's story, so many assumptions, and I guess that it makes sense. It's on the state to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that someone is guilty. It's the defense's job to find and exploit that reasonable doubt, but just the fact that Salnick tried to convince everyone that Mike and Mohammed knew each other and they were all in cahoots working together, it was bananas. In fact, Dalia had told Mohammed that if he ever called her and she couldn't talk, she would just use a code and say, "I'll pull the listings for you," and that would be his sign that Mike was around and she'd have to call him back. There's plenty of texting going on between Dalia and her three suitors, Mike Dippolito, Mike Stanley, and Mohammed, but never once is there even the slightest hint of a reality TV show hoax. Not once. I could talk for hours about this trial. I spent days watching it, but we don't have the time for that. At the end of her first trial, the jury came back and decided that Dalia was guilty. Selnick announced their plans to appeal before they even went to sentencing, but they still did have to go through a sentencing hearing. Now I'm going to play you a little clip of what Mike Dippolito had to say after hearing Dalia's sentence.
Let me just start off by saying, you know, when I married my wife, I was very much in love with her. And I thought we were doing things that normal married people do. And I was a very good husband. And I provided everything we needed. And, you know, that being said, lo and behold, you know, that wasn't the case. I don't know who these people are talking about, but it's not that girl. You know, and I feel bad. I don't even want to be here. Since this started, I've always put my hand out. Get in my house. Let's be done with it. I'll beg the judge to even do whatever. I don't personally gain anything from this. You know, the difference between me and I guess what's going on here, you know, I went to prison. You know how I got there? I said, I did it. Yeah, I did it. Let's get this over with and handle it. You know, that hasn't happened here. All I've had to deal with is before, you know, the money stolen, my victim's money, my house. I'm still married. I don't have my home back. It's my house. I bought that house. I'm going to get it through a divorce. It's mine. And there's no arguing that. I don't have it. I mean, this girl doesn't feel sorry for anything. She still doesn't think she did anything. And believe me, I don't want to get up here and be nasty, but the reality is I sit and listen to this. Even today, we're talking about a retrial? Retrial for what? I mean, what is it we're doing? Who didn't understand what happened here? They still don't want to admit anything happened. Nothing bad happened. It's all good. Let's just all go home and it's fine. You know, yeah, I'm a convicted felon. Oh, I'm a bad guy. I'm not that bad. I worked my butt off to pay these people back. And then, you know, to go through all this, and like I said, the whole way, I'm just waiting to hear, okay, we'll try and fix this and give you a And I would have came in here and I'd have said, you know what, Judge, send her on a vacation. She deserves it. I'd have said anything because you know why? If she would have owned it like a normal person and would have owned up to something, I would respect that. But instead, when I get to court, I hear that I want a reality television show. Not only is she coming, like, her lawyers alone, it's ridiculous. You should have just said space aliens landed, and they did it. That would have been a better defense. You could have made that up. You know, and I had to sit through this. I want a reality show. That's ridiculous. Did I wish all this didn't have to happen? Yes, I wish it didn't have to happen. But the reality is, you know, I didn't do this. Just like I said in the beginning, I have nothing to do with this. I didn't do it. I can't imagine in a million years if she wanted to do the right thing and she wanted to steal my money and leave me, she'd get a divorce. This isn't a wholesome person. This isn't a person that has any regret, any remorse. As soon as we walk out of here, you know they're filing for an appeal. You know why? Because they think everybody in this room is stupid. That's why. Because we're all stupid and they're smarter than us. And nobody did anything. And God, she's a great girl. And you know, when I met her, I thought all those things. But after I went through all this and realized, that's not even close. I'm just not that type of person. And I don't want to be up here nasty. And, you know, but the reality is, again, I sat here today and felt like I was getting shit on. Again. You know, it's just never ending. It's just never ending. You know, maybe it's my fault. I'm too nice of a person. I don't know. But I'm not going to change who I am. You know, that's not the point here. I thought we were even supposed to be having a baby. You know, I wasn't allowed to talk about certain things, you know. I'm under the impression we're starting a family. I'm just a fool, I guess, but that aside, I guess I've said enough.
And during the sentencing hearing, Mike Dippolito and Michael Selnick would find themselves face to face again, arch enemies forevermore. Mike gave a moving victim statement about how this whole thing had affected him. And after, Selnick started questioning him about the townhouse and how, you know, Dalia was willing to sign it back over to him. And Mike responds with, "You're going to give me back something that's already mine?" Selnick ends up throwing the deed to the townhouse in Mike's lap, which was a very uncouth action on behalf of a defense attorney. And he stated to him, "Here you go, take it. Your house is signed back in your name. You know, we don't want anything in return." To which Mike replies, "Wow, thanks for giving me back my own house. You did me a solid. I already own this house. I paid for it." the little stunt with the house, you know, them giving the house back, it didn't save Dalia during sentencing. Neither did her mother, Rhonda, sobbing on the stand, begging mercy for her daughter. The judge presiding over the trial, who was named Judge Colbath, I really liked him. I thought he was funny and very fair. He plainly stated to Dalia that what she did was pure evil, and she was sentenced to 20 years in prison. It was a happy medium between the 30 that the prosecution had wanted and the 4 that Sound Like had wanted. Dalia returned to her cushy house arrest while her appeal was pending, and in April of 2013, the appeal was filed and she was granted a new trial. The judge agreed that the jury pool had been tainted due to one of the potential jurors mentioning during selection that she'd heard from her husband Dalia had tried to poison Mike with antifreeze, a little fact that had not been allowed into the first trial. The next year, in July of 2015, Brian Claypool joined Dahlia's defense team, a heavy hitter in the legal world. And this ended up making the news considering he was a prominent California trial attorney, but he caused waves as soon as he came on. He caused waves the whole time, honestly. He loved to talk to the media. He loved to kind of, like, say things. He said things about, you know, the judge, like, if the judge finds her guilty after hearing the defense's argument, like, that's not a good legal move. He would just talk junk about the judge. And he was also the one who announced that Dalia had given birth while on house arrest, right as her second trial was getting started. She just wanted to get home to be a mother to her 2-year-old little boy. None of the men we have been introduced to thus far were the father of this baby, in case you are wondering. Dalia also took the stand for the first time ever in 6 years during the pre-trial hearing, and she told everyone she was just an innocent victim who'd been following a script. I think that this, coupled with the fact that the second trial was completed in a day and a half with only 2 witnesses, it contributed to the jury being deadlocked, 3-3. It's worth noting that during this trial, the whole reality TV defense had been completely dropped and it was never brought up again. This time, Brian Claypool went full force against the Boynton Beach Police Department, claiming they had failed to investigate whether or not Dalia was in fact a victim of domestic abuse, and that they'd fabricated the murder-for-hire plot to impress the cops team, thereby entrapping Dalia. Mike Dippolito was not called to the witness stand during this trial, leaving the jury with no face to give the victim, and Dalia's past bad acts of trying to set Mike up and poison him were not discussed either. A juror from the first trial who watched the second one on TV was astonished, and she claimed she still 100% believed that Dalia was guilty, but they hadn't given any information in the second trial. They hadn't given really important things that added to the substance of what Dalia was doing and had done to Mike for 6 months. The third and final trial, so far, it happened in 2017, and here the jury would convict Dalia again, taking only 90 minutes to reach their verdict. This time, the prosecution wouldn't hear of any cushy house arrest for Dalia, since she was now considered a flight risk. A jailhouse conversation between Dalia and her baby daddy had been recorded, and Dalia was telling him the story of an inmate in South Carolina who'd broken out of jail by having someone drop wire cutters into the prison using a drone. It was the prosecution's opinion that Dalia seemed so impressed with this that she might try the same, or she was trying to give her boyfriend a hint or a signal to arrange that to happen for her personally. I don't think that's the case, but Dalia deserved to be behind bars, not hanging out by the pool with an ankle monitor, so I don't care. I think she was just probably chatting. I know it may seem like I hate Dalia, but really I don't. In a lot of ways, I feel bad for her, but I also hate what she represents. Women are strong is how we can be real badasses, and Dalia spent her life looking to a man every time she needed some heavy lifting done. And she didn't achieve their help by being open and honest with them, by being a good friend or a good girlfriend or, you know, being reciprocal. She did it by manipulating them, using what she had as a woman, our great gifts, and making women all over the world look bad. During her trials, she never took accountability, which would have been so much more respectable. It was always someone else. She was always just a little buoy getting pushed around by the waves of life with no control over where she would end up. And I don't agree with that. We all make our own fates, each and every one of us, and that includes Mike Dippolito, and that includes Mike Stanley, and that includes Mohammed. They all made their decisions to become involved with Dalia. But at this point, you know, she has been in prison, and it looks like she'll be over 50 by the time she gets out. So I don't think it's impossible for her to change. I don't technically think she's a dangerous person. I think she was a spoiled brat. I think she didn't think things through. I mean, if you look at it, it's just frustrating because There's nothing in her past that would suggest she would turn out like this. There was no abuse on behalf of her parents that can be proven, even though she says that there was. There's no abuse on behalf of Mike towards her, her husband, even though she says there was. For the most part, it looked like her family, especially her mother and her siblings, they were all very close, and they supported her, and they held her up. They took care of each other. So she seems to have a pretty normal family life and didn't have an abusive relationship with Mike. But at the same time, I have to remember that this woman, she was an escort for many years, you know. She was 19 when she started. And a lot of bad things can happen to women in that kind of business and that kind of work. A lot of bad things. So we don't necessarily know what Dalia's experiences were. She's lied about almost everything anyways. And I don't think that she would maybe tell anybody that stuff. Maybe it would be embarrassing to her, or she's ashamed of it, or she's blocked it out and repressed it. Who knows? However, she was wrong. She did something that was really bad. She was callous about it. She was cruel. And Mike was a good guy, you know? She had everything. If she was looking for a happy life, she could have had that with Mike. He would have taken care of her. He would have kept her in hair extensions and tanning booths and, you know, expensive jewelry for as long as she wanted. But maybe she's just one of those people that's never happy, that's never satisfied, and they end up causing drama in their lives in order to mix it up and in order to have something new happening. I don't know, guys, but let me know what you think about Dalia Dippolito, about Mike Dippolito. Mike Dippolito, I'm Team Mike, you know. I kind of have to be. The guy's hilarious, and he actually is in a happy relationship now. He did an interview, I think, a year or two ago where he's met a new woman, and it's a trusting and happy relationship, so I'm so glad about that. He just seems like a sweetheart, you know. Yeah, he did things in his past, things that weren't good. Whatever, but he never killed anyone, and he never, you know, tried to kill anyone, so that's really what matters at the end. I can never condone anybody taking another person's life, never. All right, guys, thank you so much. Let me know what you thought about this series, and check out Magellan TV in the description box. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe if you haven't, and share the video if you thought it was interesting. Thank you so much. Stay kind and stay beautiful. I love you so much. Bye. Straight down, and that river runs deep. The mountains get steep, and the voice is getting too loud. All these feelings I've buried is looking like a cemetery.